Welcome to Tailgate Week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal.
Fired up indeed at Oklahoma State University, where the Heat's been turned up on the Cowboys after a loss in their conference opener last week. The Kansas State Wildcats have made the four-hour trek due south, and they're ready to get in the home team's grill. Today, the last two Big 12 champions meet. It's an early crossroads on the first Saturday in October. Kansas State, Oklahoma State, now. Football on ABC, presented by Buffalo Wild Wings, part of Tailgate Week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. The last two winners of the Big 12 Conference, both coming off losses. It's Oklahoma State taking on Kansas State, and it feels like football weather in Stillwater as a cold front has moved through mid-60s and a stiff breeze. And a very important game for both programs. Hi again, everyone. I'm Bob Wischusen here with Rod Gilmore. Quinn Kesnick will join us in just a moment. This early in the season, we don't normally talk about programs at a crossroads, but at least for this year, both of these teams are in that situation, it seems.
I think that's right. I think both of them have kind of struggled to find their identity on offense, and they can't afford a loss anymore. They each have one loss. The loser today is pretty much out of the conference championship race. The winner stays alive.
And that loss for Oklahoma State came in shocking fashion last week in Morgantown, and we're not normally talking about offensive struggles when it comes to the Cowboys, but their quarterback J.W. Walsh struggled last week on the road, and their offense as a whole doesn't seem to be its normal self.
Well, I think both these teams have struggled on offense and struggled with the quarterback, and for Oklahoma State, J.W. Walsh really had a tough time last week, didn't complete 50% of his passes. Yeah, he made a bad call around the goal line, but it wasn't all his fault. I mean, this offensive line has struggled, the rushing attack hasn't been there, so it's not just him. He's going to need some help today as well.
Bill Snyder has two quarterbacks. We will see both today for Kansas State.
Jake Waters, David Sams. Waters, he can sling it. He's not Colin Klein. He's not a big bruising runner, but he throws the ball very, very well. And they have to get him comfortable and get him into a rhythm. And when he's not on the field, Sams will be out there. And Sams is an elite runner. He can give you the big play, the electrifying run. And so they got to get him comfortable as well. We will see both these guys.
The crowd is fired up. We are set for football here in Stillwater. Here come the Pokes. The kickoff moments away here in Stillwater. Just about set for game time here in Stillwater. Oklahoma State, ranked 21st, taking on Kansas State in the Big 12, a game of vital importance, as we said, for both teams. The loser is going to fall into a two-game hole in the conference standings. Right now, Texas Tech rolling over Kansas. So the Red Raiders are going to win. They'll be up top. And look at Texas at 2-0. Who would have thought, with all of the turmoil in Austin, that the Longhorns would get off to a good start? But this is a very important game for both the Wildcats and Cowboys. And Quinn Kesnick is down on the field.
Has one injury and one suspension to report on. Let's start with Kansas State. Tremaine Thompson, wide receiver, kick returner. He is here. He is not dressed. According to head coach Bill Snyder, he will not play today. That is significant. He's their number two receiver and very dangerous on kick returns. Meanwhile, for Oklahoma State, Justin Gilbert, corner and kick returner. If you remember last week, ejected in the fourth quarter against West Virginia for throwing a punch. Big 12 chose to add no additional sanctions, but Mike Gundy, head coach, team imposed disciplinary action. Gilbert will not play in the first half, so Gilbert will not see him defensively or returning kickoffs until the third quarter.
And Quint, that impacts the first play of the game as Oklahoma State lost the toss. Kansas State wanted to defer their option to the second half, so it's the Cowboys that will start with the football, and that's Desmond Rowland on the near side left. Back to receive the opening kick. It takes a hop and instead falls to Shepherd at about the 11-yard line. But Rod, not only the number one kick returner not out there for Oklahoma State, but arguably their number one cover corner not going to play in the first half for the Cowboys.
Absolutely. He's an impact guy on the returns. He's an NFL prospect at the corner spot, their best cover guy. And so that's a big loss. But now the pressure is on Walsh. He had the tough week last week we talked about. He's got to come out. They got to find a way to get him comfortable right off the bat.
J.W. Walsh, not only the quarterback, but also the leading rusher so far this season for Oklahoma State. And that a big reason, according to Mike Gundy, why this offense has struggled. He doesn't want his quarterback leading the team in rushing. He needs Jeremy Smith to bust out. And here is Jeremy Smith on first down. He had 15 carries for one total yard last week at West Virginia, and that's certainly a big reason why this offense struggled.
Well, that's a way to help Walsh, is to run the football. Now, Gundy told us yesterday that on 40% of their plays, on their rushing plays, they have gained 1 yard or less. 40%. That puts you in second and long an awful lot.
Walsh on a rollout on second and long. Dumps it in the right flat. Jeremy Seaton cut down at the 33-yard line. So now it will be third down and three. Ty Zimmerman came up and made the stop.
And Walsh told us yesterday, we talked about getting comfortable, getting into a rhythm. He likes the quick game. He likes the quick passes. That's the way to get him comfortable and get him settled. They went to that right off the bat. Do they come back with that and stay with that now?
That 3-by-1 set we will see often for Oklahoma State. Three receivers to the wide side of the field on third down and three. And they'll try and run for it. Spinning free and breaking another tackle. And getting a first down is Jeremy Smith. So that's a good start on the ground, a third down conversion, as Finau missed the tackle at the line.
Yeah, a lot of talk this week, a lot written in the papers, local papers, about Smith not having a lot of yards like the pass backs have here at Oklahoma State.
Thrown to the near side, Tracy Moore. He's close to another first down. Close to midfield, about a yard shy. Picking up yards on first down in chunks, something that Oklahoma State has struggled with.
Well, yeah, and that very first play, they picked up a first down. You see the graphic there, only 3.1 yards per play on first down. That's way below the FBS average.
Smith sprints out, catches a swing pass. He gets a couple of blocks from his wide receivers and picks up four as Ty Zimmerman made the tackle. They might give him five. It'll be second down in medium. Now in plus territory for the Cowboys.
I find Walsh to be a very honest guy. And he said yesterday, quick passes, gets me comfortable, opens the game with three in a row.
Another quick hitter. Again, it's Tracy Moore. This time, he's driven back at the 45. Zimmerman came up again to make the tackle for Kansas State, so it's third down and short once again.
Well, third and short is a lot easier to manage than second and long and third and long. Now you've got options. You can throw the quick passes or you can run the football.
And Ty Zimmerman, who's been an all Big 12 honoree the last 3 years in the Big 12, terrific free safety. He is off the field, lost his helmet on that last play. So on a third down conversion chance, arguably the best defensive player out of the field for Kansas State, and that doesn't matter. Desmond Rowland couldn't pick it up as Blake Slaughter knifed through and made the tackle, and now an early decision for Mike Gundy. Do you go for it on fourth down at about 2.5?
Well, given that your offense has not been that good, not that efficient, I don't think you'd take a chance that early, and sure enough, Gundy appears to be ready to kick it away.
So Kip Smith will come out to punt. Now, Kip Smith last week had two punts that were 16 yards or under.
Yeah.
And both of those short punts resulted in the short field for West Virginia, and the Mountaineers scored touchdowns off both. This is the intentional end-over-end kick, and this is beautifully done. Spins it inside the 5-yard line. To the 2.5. Kansas State football for the first time when we come back, but they are right up against their own goalposts.
By Buffalo Wild Wings.
Welcome back. It is tailgate week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal, and we thought we'd have some fun as the tailgates were all set up outside Boone Pickens Stadium here in Stillwater today. We're going to take a look throughout the game at some of the best tailgates that we were able to find pregame here before Kansas State, Oklahoma State. Now, you can tweet throughout the game at ESPNCFB and use the hashtag OKStateTailgate, and you can vote on what your favorite tailgate was as you get a look throughout the game. So there's some pretty good tailgates going out there in these parking lots as the Kansas State Wildcats start deep in their own end. They run it with John Hubert out to about the 5-yard line for a gain of 2.5. The answer is no, you don't get a vote, because I know what your vote really entails, and that is you're looking for payola. You want someplace to go after the game while the traffic dies down where you get a free burger.
I just want good food.
I see right through you as we take a look at Jake Waters, who already heads to the sideline. One snap and a quarterback change. Here's Daniel Sams coming up.
He is the better runner. He is quite exciting.
So second down and 7 for K-State at their own 5. A swing pass out of the flat to Tyler Lockett, and he barely gets out across the 7-yard line. Shamil Gary with a nice open field tackle, and they will give him progress to the 7, sets up 3rd down and 5.
Remember we talked about the trouble with Oklahoma State offensively, not finding an identity? They have an identity on defense. And this is a tough place to be if you're Kansas State's offense. You got a defense that has you backed up, and they're really good on the outside at man-to-man coverage. When they want to get after you, they can.
So 2 snaps on offense, 2 different quarterbacks, and 5 total yards. Sams wants the football on 3rd and 5. Straight from the pocket, bullets one right to the first down marker. And it looks as if that will be good for the first down to Curry Sexton.
They get a good spot there, picks up the first down, it appears. And how about Sams coming out firing the football? He had only thrown 4 passes on the season. He's thrown half as many of that right now.
Curry Sexton turned down an appointment to Harvard to play football at Kansas State. So he's a smart guy, and you could see he knew exactly how far he had to get.
Some might question him.
to pick up the first down. And here's a design run for the quarterback, and Sam spins free. Did some work to pick up 1.5 yards. Sean Lewis tripped him up at the 9.
You know, Sams was the backup to Colin Klein last year, who was all everything. Kansas State was in the Heisman race, so a lot of folks expected Sams to win the job this year, but he was beaten out by Jake Waters. But as the season has progressed, Sams has gotten more and more time on the field.
One thing that Bill Snyder told us really impressed him was the support that Daniel Sams showed Jake Waters, in spite of the fact that it was his job to lose coming into spring practice. And now he has a chance on 2nd down and long from just inside the 15. And a false start call. So we're without the referee's microphone, at least for the time being, but that was a false start on Cornelius Lucas, the left tackle. And there is the architect of arguably the greatest program turnaround in college football history. Because if you look at what Kansas State was before Bill Snyder took over in stint number 1, the only thing that might be more impressive is he came back for now what is stint number 2 as the head coach and got them right back to where they were.
You'll get no argument from me about it. I mean, that turnaround has just been amazing from what they were to what they've become.
2nd down and long. And now flags all over the place as it is another penalty against Kansas State. So after, from starting at about their own 2.5-yard line, getting a big 3rd down conversion, back-to-back false starts puts them almost right back where they started, inside the 5, facing 2nd down and a mile.
Yeah, this is a tough, tough situation they have now. Yeah, and Sams is not the pocket passer, so I would expect they would be thinking in terms of trying to just get enough yardage to get out of this hole they're in right now.
Four-man rush, Sams from the end zone. Comes underneath, it's Sexton again. And that, a solid play out to about the 15-yard line for a gain of 10. Sets up 3rd down and manageable, 3rd down and about 8.
At 3rd and 8, now you will get the pass rush specialist for Oklahoma State in this situation. Now the key is really, how do they play Lockett on the outside? I mean, Lockett is the outstanding receiver for Kansas State. Do they single him or do they double him up here?
Well, the Cowboys have 6 defensive backs on the field. looking at a five wide receiver set for K-State, and now they show blitz. Zach Craig comes down near the line of scrimmage, and it looks as if Daniel Sams recognized it. Third down, here comes the blitz, and Sams gets out of the pocket. He'll try and run for it, reaches for the first down marker. And it looks as if they will put the football down right on the line, maybe a half yard beyond. It is a yard beyond, a scramble on third down, and a first down for K-State.
Well, we talked about him being elusive and electrifying. How about that presence of mind and that athleticism to extend the ball? Foot doesn't touch. You see the hand right on the marker, and then the ball as it breaks that plane. Good call by the crew down there.
Kansas State late getting out of the huddle. The play clock at 10. They have to hurry to get this play off. First and 10 from the 23, and now a timeout will have to be called from the sideline by Kansas State. And their coaching staff is very upset with the fact that after the third down scramble, it was lackadaisical getting out of the huddle for the Wildcats. Here's our first choice. You can tweet at ESPNCFB using the hashtag OKStateTailgate as we continue tailgate week. Fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. Choice A, under the big top.
What was on the grill?
Did you see the big top?
I was looking for the grill.
Hey, your vote is for sale and they might be buying, so they're going to cook whatever you want after the game's over if you tweet under the big top. But we'll have some other candidates as the game continues. And now after the timeout, first and 10 on a drive that already has consumed about half of the first quarter. And here's Sams on a delayed run. Spins out to about the 26-yard line for a gain of 3, brought down by Ryan Simmons.
You know, we talk about tendencies with an offense. Kansas State came out breaking a tendency. They threw the ball an awful lot, short passes. Their main goal on offense is to get to the quarterback design runs, like we just saw. The quarterback run, quarterback power, quarterback option plays. But they came out breaking that tendency, throwing the football.
We saw Jake Waters at quarterback for the first snap. It's been all Daniel Sams since. We'll see if Waters gets a chance to come back in. He's warming up, throwing some passes behind the Kansas State bench as the play clock winds down again. Straight throw from Sams. Throws it out to the perimeter, and he has Kyle Klein. So the younger brother of Colin Klein, an old Heisman candidate, picks up a first down, a gain of 11.
Well, Sams is doing a good job at the line of scrimmage, recognizing what's going on. He saw that there was soft coverage on the outside out there and changed the play. And now they've got another first down. They've been good on first down. There's Waters, who is considered the better passer. So far, Sams has been lights out.
He's perfect on this drive, 4 for 4. That was the first catch of the season for Kyle Klein without Tremaine Thompson, as he is out of today's game. Sams finds a crease. He's to the 46-yard line, a yard shy of a first down behind the blocking of Cody Whitehair.
That's that quarterback power play we talked about. You pull a lineman and you get a fullback in front, and you got yourself a convoy. Just look to that left side. You got a fullback, you got a guard out in front, and a running back. That's three extra blockers helping you on the perimeter.
Is this the Bill Snyder recipe for success or what? The 10th play of the drive, second down and short near midfield, coming up on 7 minutes. Eaten up on the clock, and again the play clock winds down. Snap with 4, and Sams this time is brought down. Got back to the line of scrimmage. Jimmy Bean made the tackle, so it will be third down and a long one, close to 2 for Kansas State.
You won't find Snyder going up tempo. That's not his deal.
This is the chess match, though, we talked about yesterday with Glenn Spencer. How deep, and he, of course, the defensive coordinator for Oklahoma State, how deep into the play clock does K-State take before they snap the ball, and how well will Oklahoma State be able to disguise what defense they're in? And now a penalty. Another false start is going to be called.
On the offense.
So Tavon Rooks, the right tackle this time, called for a false start. Now it's third down and seven.
That is the third false start on this drive. You see the reaction by Sam's out there? I mean, they had a third and short where you had lots of options, and now you have a passing situation. Oklahoma State has come in with their pass rush unit.
Play clock winding down. Once again, third down and seven, and they barely get the snap off. Sams wants the deep ball down the sideline. It's a jump ball, and it's incomplete. He was looking for Terrell Miller, but good positioning by Kevin Peterson in coverage. That's the first incompletion for Daniel Sams, and it brings up a punt.
Well, Peterson, Patman have done a great job at corner the last couple weeks. And Gilbert is out today. Keep in mind, at least he's out for the first half. He's their best corner. But Peterson was excellent in coverage.
If there was ever a drive that didn't even reach midfield, much less result in points, but was still successful, that was probably it for Kansas State.
Keeping the Oklahoma State offense on the sideline.
They ate up over 8 minutes and ending up with a big flip of field position as Josh Stewart is buried inside the 15-yard line. Ty Zimmerman downfield to make the stop on special teams. A 46-yard punt, and now Mike Gundy's offense back to it.
Wild Wings.
Welcome back to Stillwater. Time-consuming opening possession for Kansas State. No points, but Oklahoma State has the football back late in the first quarter, and it's time now to take a look at our impact players, brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
Well, we saw the Kansas State offense. Hubert has a chance to be number two all-time to Darren Sproles. Lockett had 237 yards receiving against Texas, and Smith struggled last week, needs a big game today. Stewart may be the best receiver in the Big 12, but he got concussed last week.
Playing today, though, J.W. Walsh on the edge. And that slant very close to a first down as it is pulled in by Brandon Shepherd. Second down and one for Oklahoma State at their own 21. What a contrast of styles. One team that wants to go lightning fast, NASCAR pace, maximum snaps and possessions. And the other side likes nothing better than to slow things down and shorten the game. J.W. Walsh, quarterback draw. He's got the first down. Out to the 26-yard line, a gain of five for Walsh.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how effective Stewart and Seals are for Oklahoma State, given that they were both concussed and knocked out of last week's ball game.
There's Juwan Seals. He is on the field, running off before this play, Josh Stewart. So he's on the sideline for first and 10 at the 26. Walsh has to throw this one away. Well, last week we saw two pretty scary injuries to both Josh Stewart and Juwan Seals. Here's Stewart, and watch the head bounce off the turf. He left the field with an apparent concussion, and Juwan Seals was hit with a shoulder in the back of his helmet. He was down for a while, unsure whether both would be able to play this week, but both declared healthy by the OSU doctors, and according to Mike Gundy, that's all he listens to. Listens to the doctors, they said they could play, and they are both in the lineup today. Maybe a catch and a fumble recovered by Stewart, unless they're going to rule it an incompletion, and they will rule it an incomplete pass. So it will be third down and 10.
Well, you know, Gundy, in talking about the two players who were knocked out of last week's game, said, hey, you know, there is a process in place for concussions here at Oklahoma State. And they follow that. They check computer testing of numbers for the players to see if they match up with their baseline that they had preseason. And when they meet that number and the doctors clear them, they return to practice and gradually increase their participation, and they cleared them to play.
Third down and 10, trying to keep the drive alive, the Cowboys. Their play clock time down to five. Here comes a blitz from K-State. J.W. Walsh over the middle. That one's thrown. His intended receiver, Tracy Moore, and Moore couldn't reach back to make the catch. Ty Zimmerman there in coverage, but that time J.W. Walsh didn't lead his receiver.
Now, Shue, I'm not a fan of letting a guy return to play you know, after a concussion. I think a guy ought to be out a week or two, and I think the NCAA will be moving towards some kind of a uniform rule. Oklahoma State is following their policy, but I just think, generally speaking, you're going to see movement because of all the issues with concussions in the NFL and high school and college football.
You're at the NFL has now a uniform policy.
Yeah.
College football does not. It varies school to school. As Kip Smith, a little slow to come off after that last punt of 41 yards. And as a result, there is more gray area with whether or not maybe it's the right move, maybe it's the wrong move to let players come back. It seems like it's more cut and dry in the NFL. You think that college football will eventually move in that direction?
I do, and every coach is trying to do the right thing. Mike Gundy is following what the procedure is here, and no coach wants to put a guy in harm's way, but there's so much uncertainty out there, and there's so much litigation. I think that the NCAA is going to step in at some point and say, here's what we do generally across the board, and the safest thing for players. We know that more time makes it better for players who've been concussed.
Second possession for Kansas State. Much better field position. Sands up the seam. He's got Glenn Gronkowski. The fullback slips the seam, and there he goes. A K-State touchdown. Did Daniel Sams ever sell that fake? What a terrific play by the quarterback. And the youngest of the Gronkowski brothers takes it the distance.
Well, they are such a heavy run team. Oklahoma State is so focused on it, and their key was Sams is primarily a running quarterback, so any indication that there is a run or a run fake with him in the game, they're biting on that. Hook, line, and sinker.
Stunned silence in Stillwater after the longest play from scrimmage so far this season for Kansas State gets them on the board.
And keep your eye on Sean Lewis, number 11. See how he gets caught up inside. Gronkowski gets by him, and nobody's going to catch him. K-State's offense alive and kicking.
The longest play from scrimmage so far this season for Kansas State results in a Glenn Gronkowski touchdown. The only problem for Bill Snyder, it took not enough time off the clock, but let Glenn Gronkowski get into the act as we take a look at the five Gronkowski brothers. Gordy's the only baseball player, played in the Angels organization, but of course Rob with the Patriots, Dan with the Browns, Chris with the Chargers, and now Brad Shepard gets to the sideline. Good return out close to the 35-yard line. And Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Windows, showcases the nation's longest win streak. Urban Meyer's undefeated fourth-ranked Buckeyes head to Evanston to take on Northwestern. Pat Fitzgerald has the Wildcats undefeated as well. And this will be a showdown tonight under the lights on ABC at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific.
You know, the matchup of the Ohio State offense against the Northwestern defense, that part's a mismatch, which is why I think Northwestern is going to have to score an awful lot of points to win that ball game, because that's a mismatch. Ohio State is so much physical, bigger, stronger, faster on offense.
The diamond formation on first down for Oklahoma State, and a handoff to Smith. Jeremy Smith with a flag down out to the 40-yard line.
Prep to stop number 7, Kim Nate.
Personal foul.
Hard to tell or hear who that penalty was on, but it is a face masking call and a personal foul that will make that all in all a 21-yard gain into plus territory for Oklahoma State.
That will help Oklahoma State get some field position and maybe some rhythm to their offense.
Flea flicker, J.W. Walsh. He's got Jawan Seals ahead of the field, and he hauls it in just shy of the goal line. You couldn't draw it up any better on the fake. Kip Daly tried to get back in coverage.
It should have
been a walk-in touchdown, but it is not.
He was so wide open, Walsh didn't want to overthrow him, and he just tried to get it to him so he could catch it. If he puts it out there 5 more yards, he walks into the end zone.
Diving for the end zone, and in. It only takes one play for Jeremy Smith to capitalize, and Oklahoma State is a point after away from a tie. The trick play for the Cowboys sets up a 1 yard touchdown plunge from Jeremy Smith. The 32nd rushing touchdown of Smith's career, and we're tied at 7.
Well, keep in mind the tempo of this offense. You know, they had the penalty, they come right back in, and you see the flea flicker there. You get Seals wide open, but right after this, they rush down the field and they line up. There's no chance to change around your defense and get your goal line in there. Instead, Oklahoma State gets right up on the ball and goes right away with Smith inside for the touchdown. That's what the up-tempo offense can do for you.
And it seems academic and simple, but the most important thing that Juwan Seals did on that play, he caught the football.
Yeah.
Because last week we talked with Mike Gundy about the loss to West Virginia, and he said, you know, in spite of the fact that we had 15 carries by Jeremy Smith for 1 yard, in spite of the fact that J.W. Walsh turned it over, it could have been a completely different game if we had just caught a couple of deep balls. We had receivers behind defenders and dropped a couple that turned out to be huge.
Well, yeah, and keep in mind that they had the two terrible punts, which were like turnovers. The offensive line play was weak. They had guys in the backfield making it tough on Smith. But yeah, receivers dropped a number of passes last week.
Tyler Lockett gets to the sideline with a flag down. Tyler Lockett with a big return if the play stands, but a flag thrown back at the Kansas State 30-yard line.
Right at the tackle to number 24. Number six.
First of all,
it's a personal foul called against Kansas State, so wipe away what would have been a 68-yard return. We had the drive that took 8.5 minutes for Kansas State. We've now had two touchdowns in 51 seconds between these two teams. The trick play may get Oklahoma State's offense going.
Yeah, but you know, they really need some rhythm. That's a great play. It may help them get them going, but you know, they've got to get squared away again, rushing the football a little bit and making sure Walsh is comfortable. They started that first drive and that worked out for him. The flea flicker, trickeration helps, gets the fans excited, but for the duration of the ball game, they need some consistent chunks on offense throwing the football.
Well, we talked with Mike Gundy about it. If last season had been when Wheaton to Blackman was here and all of the offensive weapons were on this team and they had a letdown offensively this year, you might make sense of it. But last year, Oklahoma State went through three different quarterbacks and put up great numbers, as now Jake Waters is back in at quarterback, and an end around to Sams. So quarterback to quarterback picks up a couple of yards as we go back to Chris Cotter.
Time for the Taco Bell studio update. We go to the big house where they're playing for the little brown jug. Minnesota's Mitch Leidner finds Max Williams from 7 yards out. Michigan and Minnesota tie at 7.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. We are also tied at 7 as we may be playing the last play of the first quarter here on 2nd down and 9. And it's back to Jake Waters at quarterback. He'll throw a quick hitter to the 16. Turning upfield is Tyler Lockett. And that should take us to the end of the first quarter, as Tyler Lockett had a huge game 2 weeks ago against Texas. 13 catches for 237 yards. A new K-State single game record for receiving yards. We are tied at 7 at the end of the first quarter here in Stillwater. Telecast is available in stunning high definition, brought to you by Vizio, live and in color. Pistol Pete has had some reasons to cheer and create a great atmosphere here in Stillwater, as the Cowboy fans were in place early, welcoming their team back home off of a tough loss last week on the road at West Virginia. Now they're in a 7-7 tie with Kansas State as we start the second quarter. Bob Beschusen, Rod Gilmore, and Quinn Kesnick here. Boone Pickens Stadium, 3rd down and 5 to start the second quarter. Right over the head of Tyler Lockett.
Were you surprised to see Waters in there, considering that Sams has been the story of the game so far for K-State?
Well, Bill Snyder said that both players will play and deserve to play. He had Waters in for the first snap of the game, then made the quarterback switch. I was wondering if you were surprised that he made his first quarterback switch as quickly as he did.
Yeah, I was. But, you know, Sam's was hot. I mean, Sam's in the first quarter had a hand in or was responsible for 117 of the 124 yards of offense K-State had.
Fair catch called for and made at the 40-yard line by Josh Stewart. So good field position for the Cowboys at their own 40. And with only seven races left, NASCAR's best continue the drive for the championship. Matt Kenseth looks to hold off Jimmy Johnson and Kyle Busch for the top spot. It's round four of the chase for the Sprint Cup. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Kansas presented by Dodge Durango. Tomorrow at 1 on ESPN, also live on Watch ESPN.
I'm worried about Kyle Busch.
I was waiting for my Rod Gilmore NASCAR nugget of the week.
Well, Kyle Busch crashed his car this morning, and so he's going to have to ride his backup car tomorrow.
As did Kurt Busch.
Ah.
How about that? They're both in their backup cars tomorrow.
Not a good deal.
I like when I can educate you as well.
No, I was aware of it, but only Kyle mattered to me.
Gain of two on first down.
I mean, Kyle is sitting at number three. Kurt's, what, 18? And Kyle's the one that's got a shot at this thing.
Jod Goodlett making the catch. Sets up second down and 8. Diamond formation on second down and 8. On a keeper, it's J.W. Walsh. Brought down about 3 yards shy of the first down by Ty Zimmerman.
I love that diamond formation. One of the things that it gives you is it forces the defense to declare how they will play your receivers. If they single up on them, you've got a chance to get a big play. If they bring their guys outside and they double or play zone defense, you can run the ball like you did right there.
Third down and 3. Walsh on a slant. He's got a first down and more. David Glidden all the way down inside the 40-yard line of Kansas State.
Walsh looking comfortable. Those quick passes to start the game seems to have given him some rhythm.
The catch. He was hit hard, a gain of 12, and 3 flags fell.
That's going to be a personal foul. Might even be a targeting foul.
So it is a face masking call. Again, we're having a part-time hearing the referee's mic down on the field, but tack on 15 more for Oklahoma State.
Yeah, watch the end of the play. There's the face mask, and then there is the extra hit at the end, but that was not a targeting foul. Good wrap up there at the end of that tackle by Evans, number 15.
Lake Slaughter was called for the face mask, so it's a first down at the 13-yard line for the Cowboys. A design rollout for Walsh. The intended receiver was Jeremy Seaton. It'll be second down and 10.
One of the reasons for the quick passes that helped this team is that the offensive line has struggled in pass protection, and teams have attacked the right side of this offensive line. Down here in the red zone, they've been pretty good this year. Last week, they had a terrible one that they missed on the goal line, but they've been 15 of 16 on the season.
And all 15 of those scores were touchdowns. Walsh on a keeper. Can't get to the corner. A tuck back to about the 12-yard line, but Dante Barnett with a good job to beat J.W. Walsh to the spot. Now, J.W. Walsh yesterday was telling us how fast he is. He was actually saying that he thinks he's faster than wide receiver Josh Stewart, who's his best friend from high school. Well, that time, if that is true, Dante Barnett's faster than both of them.
Yeah, exactly. Now, you're in the red zone here, inside the 20-yard line, and Walsh changed a play last week on the goal line. I don't think he's going to change a play down here. I think he's going to go with what's called, and they're in a passing situation.
Third down and 10. Walsh with a tipped ball, and it falls at the 1-yard line. That one got hit at the line. Ryan Mueller may have gotten a piece of it, so we'll see if the first field goal at the end of a red zone opportunity can take place now for Oklahoma State.
It looks like that was Mueller. Is that Mueller 44 who gets the left hand up there?
30-yard field goal attempt for Ben Grogan. He is only 1 for 4 this season and missed a huge momentum swinging field goal from short range last week off the uprights against West Virginia. This one, though, is true. So the true freshman knocks it through, and that gives Oklahoma State a 3-point lead. 3 minutes gone by in the second quarter. Welcome back to Stillwater, ESPN College Football, presented by Buffalo Wild Wings, all part of Tailgate Week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. The tailgates were cooking before the sun came up here in Oklahoma, and Oklahoma State has now gone on top by a field goal, but alongside Rod Gilmore, I'm Bob Beschusen. Quinn Kesnick down in the field. And a hooked field goal out of bounds by Kip Smith.
How about the Kansas State offense? You know, they've changed their personality in this ballgame. And they've handed the ball off twice in this game and once to a quarterback, and they came out throwing it. I mean, that's not what you expect from Bill Snyder.
Where would you go now if you're Bill Snyder at quarterback?
I would stick with Sams. I mean, Sams has been the guy. He's been the hot hand. And not just running the football. I mean, he's made good decisions at the line of scrimmage, changing plays to throw the football, and he's found the right matchups.
It is Sams coming out to start this drive with good field position as Kansas State, after the kick out of bounds, will start at their own 35. Lockett in motion. And a little speed draw to Lockett. Turns the corner. And he has a 6-yard gain as we check in with Chris Cotter.
Bob, it's time for the Dr. Pepper 10 Conference Update. Let's go to the ACC. Georgia Tech in Miami, the option working to perfection here. Charles Perkins takes the pitch, 31 yards for the score. Miami just scored, though, 17-14, Tech on top.
So a 3-point game in the ACC. We have a 3-point game here in the Big 12, and a crucial Big 12 game for both of these teams, coming off of losses both in their last outings. 2 weeks ago, Kansas State lost in Austin to Texas. And last week in Morgantown, Oklahoma State lost to West Virginia. Sams wants the deep ball into double coverage for Lockett, and it's incomplete, and Lockett's hurt. He pulled up and grabbed his hamstring. That is vital for Kansas State. Tremaine Thompson already out of the game with an illness, and he made the trip. Dressed during warm-ups, but he is over on the sideline, not even in pads. And now you get your best overall receiver, Tyler Lockett, pulling up lame on a deep ball.
So you take away your two top receivers. That really changes everything you can do offensively. You just see right there, Lockett pulls up and he grabs that right hamstring. He was well covered anyway, but never had a chance to make a play on the ball. So what do you do if you don't have him now?
Well, it is a lot of inexperience at wide receiver as a result. There's Tremaine Thompson, not suited up for today's game. So right now, Deontay Burton, who is a redshirt freshman from Manhattan, is in the huddle taking the place of Tyler Lockett. Curry Sexton is a junior. He came into today with 12 catches. Terrell Miller, we've already seen out on the field. He came into today with a couple of catches as well. And Deontay Burton, we just saw part of this five wide receiver look, has yet to make a reception this season.
They're not the same threat. They're not the same kind of guys that force you to double cover or change your defense.
And now it's third down and 4. Sams has his man. Again, it's Curry Sexton. And that's good for a first down to midfield, a third down conversion. The first play of that last series was an end around to Lockett. Now we're going to take another look and see, did he start to favor that hamstring?
Yeah, it looks like he pulled up a little bit there. Not clear if it was the hamstring, but clearly it's the hamstring here. So maybe on that end around, it started to go a little bit. And then when he did the go route and really turned it on, that's when it went.
Sams, nice fake again. And he's got another first down. That was identical to the fake where he was able to spring Gronkowski on the little slip up the seam for the long touchdown. That time he kept it and gained 11.
Well, when you think about who are your big play guys, and defensively you always look at the offense and you say, who do we have to take away? Well, since Kansas State's big play guys are now out of the ballgame, I mean, the big play guy is Sams. And he's the guy that can make people miss and can outrun guys.
Sams to Hubert, and he dances for about 4 yards, and his helmet comes off, so he'll have to go to the bench. It'll be second down and 7. Well, Ron, here's my question about the quarterbacks. Does the fact that Tremaine Thompson is not able to play in today's game, and now Tyler Lockett might be out, end the day possibly for Jake Waters?
I don't know that that's the case. I think that, you know, Sams is hot right now. And there was a plan to get him more playing time. And Waters, you know, he'd had the turnover issue. I think he's going to see time. But I just think that right now, as hot as Sams has been, you have to keep him in the ballgame.
Pistol formation with Robert Rose, the 5'4" senior from Miami, heading out to the far side left. And Sams goes right up the middle for about 2.5 yards, sets up third down and medium. I guess the question being, though, Jake Waters is known as the thrower.
Yeah.
If the top two targets to throw the football to aren't now available, do you have to leave it in Sam's hands because he is that more balanced run-pass threat? And the fact that his run ability being on the field might make up for the fact that Thompson and Lockett are out
well,
there for
well,
you.
Keep in mind, we've also seen both of them on the field. We've seen Waters hand off to Sam's. So we still may see some of that, but you've got to make some plays on the perimeter.
Big play here, third down and 5. Play clock down to 6. Three tight ends in the game, and now Sams has to turn and call timeout with the play clock winding down almost to 0. Kansas State driving. They're down a field goal. We'll step aside for just a moment here in Stillwater.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Edward Jones. Join the nearly 7 million investors who know FaceTime and ThinkTime make a difference. Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy. And Midas, they'll tell you what you need and what can wait. Trust the Midas touch.
Here's option B for our tailgate competition via Twitter. You can go to @ESPNCFB, use the hashtag OKStateTailgate. B is the ambulance, a converted ambulance.
Okay.
You take the smoker out of the back of the ambulance, then if someone's not feeling well, you've got medical facilities right there after they eat about 6 of those sausages right off of the smoker. I mean, to me, that's practicality. That's thinking about your guests.
That's creative.
As well.
That's getting my attention.
So we've got under the big top in the ambulance as choices A and B. Some good tailgates out there, and here's a big play after the timeout. Third down and 5, another penalty called against Kansas State. That is their 7th penalty here in the first half.
False start on the offense. Number 78, 5-yard penalty, third down.
And 4 of those penalties, I believe, have been of the false start variety. It makes you wonder why they aren't perhaps using a silent count, because they're clearly being affected by the crowd and the noise.
Third down and close to 10 now. Just a shade under 10. Kansas State, 3 of 5 on third down here in the first half. They are not in field goal range yet. 3-man rush. Sams able to buy time. Fires one into double coverage, and it's broken up and almost intercepted. Tyler Patman cut over, and he had a chance to pick that ball off. And now what do you do if you're Bill Snyder? Fourth down and long. At the same time, though, you're not in field goal range.
Yeah, that's a long, long get. They baited him on that play. I mean, great disguise. They showed man coverage at the very beginning and then jumped out of it to a zone. Sams didn't pick it up and threw right into the zone coverage.
Well, Coach Snyder is going to play field position.
Has to.
It'll be Mark Krause coming on to punt, and his job will be to try and kill this inside the 10-yard line. Josh Stewart deep to receive at the 10. And the end-over-end kick, will it get hung up in the wind? Lands in the end zone. So the field position decision by Bill Snyder ends up with a touchback as we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. And it's the work, all in all, done by Daniel Sam so far, throwing and running.
Well, he's been it. I mean, this is a guy who came into this ballgame having thrown four passes. He's thrown nine already today, completed six of them, including a touchdown pass, picked up a key first down with a huge dive, and has really had command of this offense.
Desmond Rowland now in the game as the back behind J.W. Walsh. A blitz off the edge. Walsh avoids a sack. Throws it to the sideline, and it's scooped up by Jawan Seals for an 8-yard gain.
Well, most teams have been attacking the Oklahoma State offense on the right side. The right side of the line is where they bring their pressure, their blitzes. Walsh does get this out, and that ball was caught by Seals.
Randall Evans came on a corner blitz, and Walsh did a good job to extend the play. Now it's second down and one. Desmond Rowland does not get the first down, or at least not seemingly so. Well, Marquell Bryant made the tackle. Let's see where they spot the football. No, they're going to give him progress to the 30 and say he did pick up the first down.
But Shue, what we've seen the last couple of plays is Kansas State attacking that right side of the line. And Oklahoma State, we know, they have more confidence going to their left. But they have to do some things to the right side to balance it out and keep Kansas State, you know, honest. But I suspect you're going to see more plays moving to the left side for Oklahoma State.
Tripped up a yard behind the line. Travis Britz gets the takedown. That's his second sack this season. And the first on the day for Kansas State.
Yeah, and Britz came from inside. You see him to the left of your screen, that right side again. He's working against the right guard over there. That's Chris Grisby he's working against, and he makes the play.
Four-man rush on second down and long. And now it'll be third down and manageable as Marcel Aitman makes his first catch of the day. That's the eighth different receiver on 11 receptions by Oklahoma State. None of those passes have found Josh Stewart,
yeah,
who is the favorite target, yep, of J.W. Walsh.
And maybe the best receiver in the Big 12. And he's a guy that has not been effective today. Remember, he's a guy that was knocked out of last week's ball game with a concussion.
Third down and six for an Oklahoma State offense that does not look like the group we've seen in years past. K-State shows blitz. They'll rush five. J.W. Walsh just short of the first down. It looks as if that reception is made. Marcel Aitman with back-to-back catches. And let's see where progress gets him. Just shy of the 40-yard line, which is the first down marker. And that might be a pretty favorable spot for the Cowboys.
Yeah, that might be a bit generous. You have to keep your eye on where's the ball. About
very
the 39.
Favorable.
It was short of the first down. That's a fair enough spot.
Short by a foot.
Yeah, you know, you want to go, but you can't go. You can't go. You're in your own territory. You're up 10-7. You miss this one, you give a short field.
For a moment there, you were like the cartoon bubble coming out of the head of the fans and then out of the head of Mike Gundy all at the same time.
Reason prevails.
You want to go. All the fans are yelling and screaming, but you can't go. And now a timeout called, I think, by Kansas State as they had defensive personnel on the field. They were waiting to see what the
field was going to do.
When the punt unit ran out, they were late getting players off, so they had to call a timeout as a result. Fourth down punt coming up.
back in Stillwater. Oklahoma State up by a field goal, set to punt here on fourth down. Keep in mind, punter Kip Smith, the UCLA transfer, earlier in this ball game had his left ankle rolled on. He spent a lot of time retaping that plant foot ankle, a lot of practice strokes on the sideline. Doesn't look 100%. Keep in mind, he did kick off the ball out of bounds earlier as well, so he's not 100% here. Let's see how he does.
And after the timeout, just gets it away, and he gets bumped into, and the flag comes out. That's going to be a first down for Oklahoma State. And now a fumble on the catch attempt by Ty Zimmerman. And did Zimmerman get it back? It looks like he did. If Zimmerman fumbles the ball, Oklahoma State recovers. Obviously, they would end up inside the 30-yard line. If not, the penalty will most likely give the Cowboys a first down the other way. That is a huge penalty. That's equivalent to a turnover by Kansas State.
Yeah, and there's no question about it here. I mean, Smith gets his ball off, and you see from the left side of Smith, pressure, and then it was Mueller on the right side of Smith that comes in and gets him. And he just didn't control himself, had his head down. You got to keep your head up and see where you're going. And Mueller did not see where he was falling and went right into Smith.
What a huge factor penalties have been here in the first half. Eight penalties for 65 yards for Kansas State. No penalties called against Oklahoma State so far. And what amounts to a turnover as J.W. Walsh with a pump fake. Watch the home run ball, looking for Stewart. In stride, and he drops it inside the 10-yard line. The high school teammates almost with a home run play. And Josh Stewart, normally Mr. Reliable, couldn't hold on.
Well, Mike Gundy said he watched him all week in practice for after effects from last week's concussion, and he said he looked fine to him. You know, he said it was one thing to have, you know, the medical staff clear him, but he likes to watch guys and see how their eyes are, and that he thought Stewart was fine. So I don't think this has anything to do with last week based on what Gundy told us.
Four-man rush on second and 10. And Kansas State, what a turnaround. That's trying to shovel one off as he was going down. As Ryan Mueller looked as if he had the sack on J.W. Walsh. Walsh throws it to nowhere. It was a forward pass, but it might be intentional grounding.
It's got to cross the line of scrimmage. You might consider him outside of the tackle box, but there was not an intended receiver anywhere near, and it certainly didn't cross the line of scrimmage. Now, the only explanation is if they somehow considered him to be within the tackle box.
Probably a liberal definition, but yeah. It does go as just an incompletion and a quarterback draw on third down and long. Walsh has the first down. What a turnaround. J.W. Walsh on the design quarterback run picks up 13 yards.
Whenever your quarterback runs, you get an extra blocker. You see on that right side a wide, wide split and a wide angle on the pass rush over there by Marquell Bryant, 45, opened up a huge lane.
Jeremy Smith has a first down. And now the run game starts to heat up for the Cowboys.
Well, Jeremy Seaton, the fullback, number 44, and Daniel Koenig, the tackle on that side. Great, great blocks by both of them to spring Smith.
Smith into a pile at about the 30-yard line for a gain of two. Ryan Mueller was the first man there as he is driven back.
You know, Oklahoma State's rushing attack has by and large been a quarterback rushing attack, you know, this season. You look at what Walsh did last week, 52 yards rushing. He's the top guy. And your best running back is Smith. He gained 1 yard.
So far this season, J.W. Walsh has been the leading rusher overall for Oklahoma State. He came in today averaging about 59 yards per game. Jeremy Smith came into today averaging 44 yards per game. Walsh this time, a quick hitter to Tracy Moore. And Moore muscles his way to about the 25-yard line, 3.5 yards shy of a first down. Randall Evans, former walk-on at cornerback for Kansas State, made the tackle. So a big play coming here. Third down, and about four at the 26.
Walsh has been great with his legs on third down.
Twelfth play of the drive for Oklahoma State. They are 3 for 7 on third down. And now a timeout will be called from the sideline by Mike Gundy. We'll take the timeout as well. Very important play coming up in a low-scoring first half when we come back.
Buffalo Wild Wings.
Big third down play now here in Stillwater. Bob Wischusen, Rod Gilmore, Quint Kesnick bringing you Kansas State and Oklahoma State. Two teams with any Big 12 title hopes that they respectively have arguably on the line today, as both have a conference loss, and it's only the first weekend in October. After the Oklahoma State timeout, third down and four. Smith on a sprint out, five-man rush. Walsh with a slant left, incomplete. Good coverage by Kip Daly on Charlie Moore. Now it's fourth down and four, and this will be a pretty long field goal attempt for the true freshman Ben Grogan, if that's the direction that Mike Gundy decides to go, and he will. Here comes the field goal unit. Grogan's long so far this season. He's only made two field goals. One of those today was a 39-yarder, so this would be his longest of the year by far, 43 yards away. Special teams touchdown. Daly takes it to the house on the blocked field goal.
65 yards. Daly just standing there, standing around waiting, and the ball just showed up in his arms.
We said it on the first Kansas State touchdown. We'll say it again. Stunned silence in Stillwater.
Yeah, just to your left, Daly, number 7, is just standing around. Didn't rush to try and block it. He just waits. You see him there, and just, whoa, out of nowhere, there's the ball. And the special teams problems continue for Oklahoma State.
So from what should have been a touchdown lead for Oklahoma State to a four-point lead the other way for Kansas State, Travis Britz, defensive tackle, gets the field goal block. And Mike Gundy has seen this play before, unfortunately, last week against West Virginia. Two missed field goals, a muffed punt return, but the two biggest special teams blunders, a 16-yard punt and a 13-yard punt, both by Kip Smith, both resulted in the short field for West Virginia, and both resulted in touchdowns for the Mountaineers. And now on the block, kick, block field goal return.
A points off of turnovers and a kick six here. You block this thing and take it back for 6 points. I mean, that's a huge turnover and a huge change in momentum. You go from basically going up by 6 points to being down by four.
Nothing turns games around, it seems, more often than special teams in college football. It's amazing how many big momentum changing plays happen on special teams.
And that one was just incredibly fortuitous for Daly to do his job and be in the right place at the right time.
Brandon Shepard from about the 8. Good return out to the 36-yard line on a dive. A return of 29 yards, and now it's time for our Aflac trivia question.
Flack.
How many 300-yard rushing games did Barry Sanders have in 1988? If I remember right, he had a decent year.
Wait, he
in 88.
He ran for a couple thousand or close to it or something like that.
25 years ago, Barry Sanders was playing here in Stillwater. Has it been that long? Are we that old? Well, Mike Gundy feels probably a few years older.
Well, Gundy played with him.
As he is now standing on the sideline, and his quarterback finds Juwan Seals up the seam for a big gainer. Well, there's a quick hitter for the Cowboys right after the blocked field goal touchdown that has them right back where they were a moment ago. 34 yards on the hitter up the seam to Seals.
Great anticipation by Walsh. He anticipated Seals coming beyond the linebacker and put the ball there before Seals got open.
Walsh over the middle again. That one's knocked away. Randall Evans got his right arm around and knocked it down as we check in with Chris Cotter.
Bob, you and Rod talking about Barry Sanders' place in college football history. How about Aaron Murray's? Here he finds Rontavius Wooten for the touchdown. On the completion before, Murray became the all-time leading passer in SEC history. Dogs lead.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. The Cats lead here in Stillwater. A big turnaround on special teams. But right back in scoring range, Oklahoma State. J.W. Walsh to the outside. The catch is made, turning upfield Josh Stewart, just shy of the first down. That keeps the clock rolling with 2 minutes to go in the first half. And that's the first catch of the game for Josh Stewart.
I tell you, if Walsh struggled last week, he's on the money today. I mean, he seems to be comfortable. His accuracy is really, really sharp today.
15 of 24 here in the first half for J.W. Walsh. Trap handoff to Smith, and he has the first down. And Oklahoma State is back in the red zone. And Kansas State's defense looking a little winded now as they've been on the field for over 7 minutes. That's the unintended consequence of blocking a field goal and running it back for a touchdown. Your defense is right back out on the field. And Oklahoma State on the attack. Walsh with a pump fake. Thought about the end zone. Throws one across his body and finds Brandon Shepherd, who scoops it up for a pickup of four.
Clock management now as you approach a minute. Gundy thinking the same thing. You've got a big second down coming up here. You have your timeouts. You don't want to lose your time and get too rushed here.
Well, let's quickly give you our answer to the Aflac trivia question. All right, Rod Gilmore, how many 300-yard rushing games did Barry Sanders have back in 1988?
I don't know, but I'll guess two.
Might have been more than that.
Oh,
four.
Whoa.
How about 332 yards against Texas Tech in the west end zone here at Boone Pickens Stadium? There is the Heisman that Barry Sanders more than earned back in the late 80s. And the guy whose job it was to hand it off to him, of course, was quarterback Mike Gundy, and now's the head coach for the Cowboys. And with 1 minute and 3 seconds to go before halftime, Oklahoma State has a chance to at least pull within one, if not take the lead, and try and turn the momentum back after a special teams touchdown was just scored by Kansas State.
They're likely to get zone coverage down here. Kansas State does not like to play man coverage. And then this short area down here, they can cover a lot of the field with their zone coverage. 39 plays so far for Oklahoma State. Only 22 for K-State.
And the officials might be adjusting the clock. The problem when the referee's microphone does not work, and it has been intermittently working at best inside the stadium, is that it's hard to communicate things to the press box. Now they've got it adjusted by 2 seconds, so 1:05 to go in the first half. Walsh bullets one that should have been intercepted. Randall Evans had it in his arms. A bad throw by J.W. Walsh that could have been a turnover. Now it's 3rd and 6.
I don't know how he missed that. I mean, he has to know they're playing zone coverage down here, and Evans doesn't move. Evans is playing the underneath zone and releases the man behind him. He's right where he's supposed to be and where Walsh should have expected him to be with that zone down there.
So Kansas State misses a chance for another big momentum changing play. Now it's 3rd down and 6. Here comes the blitz. J.W. Walsh over the middle, and where is the flag? There it is. Couldn't have been more obvious. Randall Evans just about tackled Josh Stewart, and it will be first and goal for Oklahoma State.
How bad does Evans feel? The play before, he drops a sure pick that hit him in a bad place, right in the numbers. And then he comes back, they got a full blitz on, trying to hit home, and then he gets flagged for pass interference. But he did the only thing he could do here. You're looking in the slot right here, Stewart. He gets beat, so he tackles him. I mean, when you're beat, you got to do something. You just can't give him the touchdown.
Nine penalties on K-State here in the first half. No penalties on Oklahoma State. And it's first and goal. J.W. Walsh with a beautiful fake. Muscles his way in for a Cowboy touchdown. And just like that, Oklahoma State has the lead again. Touchdown drive and a big answer by the OSU offense after K-State blocked the field goal and brought it back for a go-ahead touchdown.
Well, this diamond formation always gives you extra blockers when the quarterback runs the ball. You add on to that a great fake by Walsh. It's an easy way to get you into the end zone. Watch him lower his shoulder at the end. But great, great fake. Got both the linebackers for Kansas State sucking up inside, and Walsh gets around to the edge.
So J.W. Walsh now on the season has 8 touchdown passes to go along with 3 touchdown carries. And Oklahoma State leads by a field goal. So we're only moments away from the Cooper Tire halftime report. Robert Flores and Jesse Palmer. We'll be back in the studio, and they'll be talking about the dominant performance in Tallahassee by Florida State. Did they send a message to the rest of the ACC and Maryland? Another game going on right now. Syracuse trying to challenge number 3 Clemson. All the scores and highlights. Texas Tech, Kansas, of course, a game that affects the top of the Big 12 standings as well. Great start for Texas Tech. And the short kickoff, an intentional pooch kickoff. And now a flip forward. That's a flag down. An illegal forward pass called on Kansas State. The crowd here thought that was a loose football and maybe a fumble recovery, but that was intentionally thrown forward, and that brings out the flag. That will be penalty number 10 as Leighton Dowling, for some reason, tried to throw one forward while falling backwards. John Hubert might have been the intended receiver. Again, I don't know that we're going to have the referee's microphone. That is an illegal forward pass.
Good lip
we'll
reading
translate.
There. Yeah. Way to read those.
Well,
lips.
The hand behind the back tells you whether or not the penalty was an illegal forward pass. So it is first down for Kansas State as Oklahoma State declined the penalty, and Mike Gundy is livid.
Well, the bigger question to me is, did Kansas State call this? Or was this something that was just done? Oh, I see. I don't think this was a called play. This was simply trying to get the ball to the return man because Dowling knows he's not a guy who ought to be running the football.
Well, with 46 seconds to go in the first half, down by only 3, wouldn't you think the wise move would be
go
just
down.
Grab the
yep.
ball, fall down yep. on the ground, take a knee, and head to the locker room?
Yeah.
And Mike Gundy is looking for a further explanation from the officiating crew.
Yeah, well, Gundy is saying, hey, that's a fumble. That's what's got him upset. He thinks it was a fumble.
Well,
but
ball,
I think the officials got it right. It was a forward lateral.
He was definitely trying to flip the ball forward. And now, after watching his team commit 10 penalties here in the first half, or 9 accepted penalties, It looks like Bill Snyder will have Daniel Sams take a knee and end the first half. Tailgate week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal, continues tonight. Undefeated Pac-12 North rivals square off a big game. Number 15 Washington against number 5 Stanford. That's tonight on ESPN at 10:30 Eastern. Also live on Watch ESPN. And Mike Gundy still having his say, as it looks like Sams will take one last knee and end the first half. Not sure what he's waiting for. And that will end the first half with Oklahoma State on top 17-14. Plenty of momentum swings in a low-scoring game as we go down to Quinn Kesnick.
Coach, what is your reaction to 10 penalties?
That would tell me that we're not a very disciplined football team.
What is the solution to operating an offense now without your two top wide receivers?
Just keep doing what we do and hope the younger guys can fit in well and do what they're supposed to do.
Will we see more of the two quarterbacks on the field at the same time?
Probably.
Thank you, Coach.
All right, Quint, thanks very much. The always forthcoming Bill Snyder, as he shares his insight on his way back to the locker room. His team is down by 3. We'll head back to the studio after this. Our Cooper Tires halftime report in a moment.
Tailgate Week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal.
Presented by Buffalo Wild Wings, part of Tailgate Week. Fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. And the Cowboys are fired up with a 3-point lead at halftime over Kansas State. Very important game for both the Wildcats and Cowboys. Both have a loss in the Big 12. So the winner of today's game certainly still alive in the conference race. The loser may dig themselves too deep a hole to get out of, especially with Texas Tech and Texas both off to undefeated starts in Oklahoma, looking for their second conference win later today as well. Bob Wischusen, Rod Gilmore, Quinn Kesnick back here in Stillwater. A low-scoring first half, not what you're used to seeing oftentimes in the Big 12, but still a first half with some wild momentum swings.
Wild? Big plays. I mean, both teams gave us big plays in that first half, things that maybe you didn't expect to see, yet got in this first half. I mean, how about Kansas State here and just a long play for Gronkowski from Daniel Sams, which really kind of shocked everybody and put them on the board. And Oklahoma State comes back with Walsh and the trickeration to Seals down the field. That set up a short touchdown. And how about a kick six? Kip Daly in the right place at the right time gets Kansas State its second touchdown in the first half.
Kansas State won the toss and deferred their option to the second half. So it will be K-State ball to start the second half. And they'll start at about their own 22-yard line as we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary.
Stands out to me, you look at the bottom left-hand side, 10 penalties for Kansas State, and they're only down 17-14. I mean, that 10 penalties, that's huge. But factor in that Kansas State has lost its two top receivers. Tyler Lockett had a hamstring issue in the first half. Tremaine Thompson did not suit up. So their top two receivers are out, and that hurts their offense.
Sam's on a designed run with a cutback on first down, and he finds a cutback lane. Almost broke it as well. As it is, it's a 12-yard gain and a first down for K-State.
So without Lockett and without Thompson to stretch the field, you're limited with the big play in the passing game. So more pressure on Sams to make things happen. And he's had a terrific day so far. 9 rushes for 47 yards, and he's thrown it well. There's Lockett, helmet on, but has that right hamstring issue.
And Justin Gilbert is on the field to start off the second half here for Oklahoma State at the top of your screen, playing left corner. He made that last tackle. Oklahoma State crowds the tackle box. Sams, low throw to the outside. If it is complete to Terrell Miller, and it looks like it is ruled a completion, it's a gain of four. Evan Peterson was there to make the tackle.
You notice the cat and mouse game going on with the offense and the defense. You have Sams coming to the line of scrimmage, calling his play, and then looking to the sideline. And the defense tries to wait to the last minute to change into what they're going to do. They're disguising to try to get Sams caught off guard. Now watch, if Sams looks over, the defense will shift.
Second down and six, and as you saw, Justin Gilbert suspended for the first half after throwing a punch at the end of the game last week against West Virginia. Play clock winding down.
There's the change.
Just did get the play off. And he's loose again. He's got another first down out to the 45-yard line before he is tackled after a gain of eight.
Well, he becomes the focal point of the offense, and how much can he carry? I mean, he's the load. He's the guy that will have to run it for the big plays, and he's the guy that's going to have to throw it unless they bring Waters back in and keep Sams on the field. We saw a little bit of that in the first quarter.
How long does it take for Oklahoma State to tip their hand? Pretty much stayed where they were, and they drop seven into coverage, but they lose track of the quarterback. There goes Sams again, spun down at midfield, gained only five, and Tyler Johnson prevented it from being more than a five-yard gain as we check in with Quinn Kestick.
Leading wide receiver Tyler Lockett remains on the sideline. He's got his helmet, but since he hurt the lower right hammy in the second quarter, he has done nothing to indicate that he can actually run. He got on the bike, pedaled slowly. After halftime, you'd expect him to come out here and maybe try to do some sprints. Nothing from him, and I think his emotion says it all. He is very doubtful to return.
And Quinn also with Tremaine Thompson on the sideline. He did not even dress for today's game. A speed draw to the near side, trying to turn the corner as Hubert. And that's a good run to the 42-yard line of Oklahoma State, and another first down for K-State, a gain of eight more. You'll wonder if this is the kind of game plan, Rod, you'll have the rest of the way, a mix of John Hubert, the running from Daniel Sams, and maybe we won't see Jake Waters at quarterback again for K-State maybe. Without Thompson and Lockett to throw to.
Maybe not. Control the game, control the clock, keep the Oklahoma State offense off the field, and find a way to get others involved, like Hubert and maybe even Rose, his backup.
Four runs and one pass on this drive. Now 29 total plays for Kansas State, 17 runs and 12 passes. So it's been run heavy with the play clock winding down. That's a delay of game. There's taking the play clock down as far as you can. And then there's cutting it a little too close. And that is penalty number 11 accepted against Kansas State. And no penalties yet in the game for Oklahoma State. So what a big factor that is now you're closing in on 100 yards in penalties, 87 in total for K-State.
You think Snyder hasn't mentioned to the officials that Oklahoma State hasn't been flagged once?
Sam's looking for room and finding a bit. Back to the 41-yard line, so that's a gain of 6.5 yards or so. Sets up second down and long, second and about nine.
We're seeing more empty formation by Kansas State, and that's good for Sams. What it does is it puts five blockers on usually five or four defenders if he decides to run. That's why they're spreading it out and giving him lanes and giving him options as to what to do with the football.
Sams rolls that way, looks for Miller up the sideline. He makes the catch for a gain of about 2.5. So it's Terrell Miller, who's a senior, that came into today with only two catches on the season. Kyle Klein, the younger brother of Colin Klein, was out there on that last play as well. He's a sophomore who made his first career catch today. We've also seen Deontay Burton, redshirt freshman. He didn't make a catch so far this season. So really, Curry Sexton is the only experienced receiver that Kansas State still has that's healthy, and now they're in a passing situation, third down at seven. Sam's well protected, throws one for a first down. There's There's Terrell Miller. So the unproven receivers coming through for Kansas State, and they move the chains.
But the key there was the pass protection. There was man coverage down the field, and because Sam's had so much time in the pocket, the man coverage got beaten. No one's anywhere near him. Plenty of time to deliver that ball.
Way to about the 22-yard line for a gain of 5.5, close to 6 more.
Hubert's part of the backfield that Randy Newman would hate.
I like this line.
Yeah.
Serve it up.
Short people. They're running backs. Hubert is 5'7". Rose, his backup, is 5'4".
Now how often do you have a 5'7" tailback who's 3 inches taller than his backup?
He's the big guy.
Second down and a short 5. And again, they bleed the play clock down. Hubert again finds room. Pushes his way, it looks like, for another Kansas State first down on a drive that has already taken us inside of the 9-minute mark here in the third quarter.
Well, you know, Hubert may be short, vertically challenged, but he's not small. He's a rugged back with a lot of power, thick legs, good balance, has the ability to keep throwing off would-be tacklers.
Well, John Hubert was in high school in Waco. He broke LaDainian Tomlinson's high school rushing record in the city. Ran for 2,524 yards. And he has been close to 1,000 yard back the last couple of years. Here's Sam's to throw. Wide open at the goal line is Miller into the end zone for the touchdown. He came open late on the slant, and Sam's patiently found him, and Kansas State retakes the lead.
What a great job by Sam's and a horrible job by the secondary of Oklahoma State. And Sam's just waited for his man to come flying through, for Miller to come across, and two Oklahoma State defenders released him like they had a complete mix-up back there.
And there's the conversation between head coach and defensive coordinator as Mike Gundy turns and Glenn Spencer tries to explain. Sam's 4 for 4 for 35 yards on that drive, all 4 completions, including the touchdown to Terrell Miller.
Yeah, and as a player in the secondary, I got him, you got him. What's our coverage? Oh, too late.
Presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
If you're a Kansas State fan, you couldn't have drawn up the start to the second half any better. A time-consuming touchdown drive, and they've got the lead back.
Yeah, you ran the ball very, very well. You got Hubert involved. Sam's was lights out at the quarterback spot, very patient, and you get the touchdown pass to Miller, blown coverage in the secondary at Oklahoma State.
Justin Gilbert with his first chance to return a kick to begin here in the second half, and he tries to go the long way around and does turn the corner and finally runs out at about the 23-yard line. Let's go down to Quinn Kesnick.
Understand how Kansas State wide receiver personnel injuries affect the strategy of this ball game. That's what Mike Gundy told me moments ago. Expecting a heavy dosage of run from K-State on that first drive. He had to be extremely disappointed with the way his defense handled that drive. Also spoke with Glenn Spencer, defensive coordinator, who said the only thing that they're worried about, the empty sets. They hadn't seen any of those empty sets on tape from Kansas State yet.
Well, there's much more pressure being put on the Oklahoma State defense this season and Glenn Spencer because the offense just doesn't put up the type of points that they have in the past. The run game has not been consistent. J.W. Walsh has struggled at times. And here he goes looking for a receiver and not finding one until Seals comes back to help him out. That's a gain of only about a yard. But, Rod, there was a time last year, as a matter of fact, even with 3 different quarterbacks, much less when Brandon Whedon and the rest of the weapons used to be here for Oklahoma State, that right now, if K-State had 21 on the board, that would be no problem because Oklahoma State would have 41 on the board. But it's a different life for the OK
the OSU defense.
They've been one of the top scoring teams in college football the last several years.
Quarterback draw. And the ball's ripped out. Still loose. Jonathan Truman ripped it away from J.W. Walsh. And it is a turnover for the Cowboys.
And Truman absolutely just rips it out. I mean, Walsh is kind of held up there. Truman doesn't try and make the tackle. He's going after the turnover here. Just watch the end of this play. Watch how focused Truman is on this. There he is, and he doesn't want the tackle. He wants the football. Heck of a play.
Alana Finau came up with the recovery, but Jonathan Truman, who came into today, second on the team in tackles for Kansas State, another former walk-on. So another diamond in the rough, uncovered by Bill Snyder and the K-State coaches. Now the starting outside linebacker creates the turnover and a chance for Kansas State to add to their lead.
Keep in mind what Quint said about the rushing attack, heavy dosage expected.
Sam's instead with a pump fake. He wanted to go up the seam, and he had a man. He still picks up about 8 yards. Caleb Levy was able to cut him down, but he had Kyle Klein wide open over the middle and instead opted to tuck it under and run.
Well, the change in the offense is clear. I mean, Sam's has made some good decisions, but he's being careful with the football, as he should be. And that's one of the reasons why he's on the field more than Waters. Waters had 7 turnovers coming into this ballgame.
So often, though, you see a team after a turnover on that first play take a shot.
Yep.
And they had Kyle Klein running right up the seam into the end zone, and Sam's didn't see him. Still second down and 3, and Sam's on a keeper. Pulled down from behind by Caleb Levy, and the ball pops out, and Oklahoma State thinks they have it. Is he ruled down by contact, or is that a K-State turnover? It is a K-State turnover. Wildcats give it right back as Sam's couldn't hold on.
Yeah, Sam's is saying he was down.
Emmanuel Ogbug got the fumble recovery if it ultimately is ruled to have been a fumble.
It looks like he was down when that ball came out.
That will very clearly be reviewed. We'll come back.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by the all-new 2014 Chevy Silverado, BNY Mellon, invested in the world, and Chick-fil-A. We didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich.
That is a tailgate. In the shade, option C, if you'd like to vote at ESPNCFB using the hashtag OKStateTailgate as we continue.
So what was the first
tailgate
one?
Week fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. The first one was in the bubble.
In the
dome. And the next was the ambulance.
I remember that one.
That
clearly
was really good.
Yeah, that got my attention.
So it looks like the replay booth has made their review decision, and now they're calling the officials over to take a look at the fumble by Daniel Sams a moment ago.
If you look closely, it looks like Sams had control of the ball when he goes down, and then he hits the ground, and then the ball comes out after he hits the ground. So that, to me, is indisputable video evidence that they should overturn this and give the ball back to Kansas State.
Daniel Sams was pretty adamant as he went over to the sideline, telling his coach, Bill Snyder, and the rest of his teammates that he was down by contact and that the offense should just stay out on the field. But it was ruled a fumble on the field, and as a result, you have to have indisputable video evidence to overturn that call, which means that one of our cameras has to catch the fact that he was down by contact. And well, it seemed
there's the contact. There's the contact. There's the tackle. He's on the ground. Ball's not being stripped out. Ball comes out after he hits the ground.
And this certainly seems to be the most definitive look that we have. His rear end hits the ground, his elbow hits the ground. It certainly seems as if he still has the football.
Yeah.
Although you lose it there on that zoom in.
Yeah, you see.
And now the ball comes out.
You're absolutely right. You saw his body down, and then the elbow, and then the ball pop out.
Well, the decision has been made by the replay officials.
Stands his call. Wow. Wow.
So what they are saying is that that video was not indisputable, and that as a result, because it was called a fumble on the field, it stands as called. And I have to think, if Bill Snyder had seen the replays that we just saw on our monitor, he'd probably be a little bit more animated. So it stays as a turnover and a fumble on Sams. And here's Walsh on a keeper running to the sideline. And he scampers out of bounds at about the 28-yard line for a gain of five. So it certainly looked as if we had a look that showed that Daniel Sams was down before the ball came out.
I think they just got that wrong. I think they just flat out blew it.
Now, Second down and four.
I'm sure their rationale is, well, we couldn't tell if the ball was coming out before him, but it clearly looked to me he had the ball secured, and then he hit the ground and came out.
A swing pass bobbled around and almost on the carom, an interception chance as Jeremy Smith couldn't hold on. It'll be third down and four. Let's take one more look. Now, is this indisputable?
Watch the right hip. Right hip's down, and now there's the ball. He has his hand underneath. Ball comes out upon contact. It wasn't his elbow that hit the ground first. It was his right hip that hit the ground first.
Well, a chance still for Kansas State to get a stop on defense here and get the ball back. Third down and four. They blitz off the edge. It's picked up. J.W. Walsh rolls into the pressure. Gets to the sideline and runs out of bounds. So a good job in coverage downfield. And Ryan Mueller chased him out of bounds. It is three downs and out after the fumble recovery. And some Cowboy fans starting to boo their offense here in Stillwater.
Well, so those two fumbles almost cancel out each other, except that if you're Kansas State, you were close to scoring.
No question. Instead of having the ball inside the 25-yard line of Oklahoma State, you're going to start a new possession after the punt return. It's Zimmerman, and he'll let this bounce. It takes a high charity hop, and then he fields it and pays the price. He made two mistakes. Saved his team a little bit of field position, but a dangerous play as he takes a hit at the 17-yard line after a 54-yard punt that he let bounce.
Yeah, and he didn't want to let it have a second bounce, and he paid the price for that, but at least for Kansas State, he secured the ball.
This is ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
Bob Wischusen, Rod Gilmore, Quint Kesnick back in Stillwater. Kansas State has the ball back, and Daniel Sams' fumble that should not have been a fumble ends up not burning Kansas State as their defense gets a three downs and out. They'll start from their own 19-yard line. And Sams on a rollout on first down. Flips one, and it's intercepted! Picked off by Caleb Levy.
They threw it right to him. Couldn't get it over him. How about that? Oklahoma State coming up with a huge turnover, and Sams, who's played brilliantly, just messes this one up. Just doesn't put enough on it, and probably shouldn't have tried to get it in there in that position anyway. Look at all the black shirts. And he tried to drop it in over Levy. Can't do it. And Levy grabs it.
Second career interception for Caleb Levy, the leading tackler for Oklahoma State, the leading tackle for loss player for Oklahoma State on defense. Now he comes up with a pick. Now, none of this could have potentially happened if the fumble on Sams had not been ruled on correctly at the other end of the field. Jeremy Smith up the middle to about the 17-yard line.
Now, remember, Oklahoma State has been fantastic in the red zone this season.
J.W. Walsh in some trouble, throws it to no man's land. Now, if we ever do get an iffy call, and there might be one here.
Well, he got away with one earlier.
Was that intentional grounding? As Parker Graham, the left tackle, might have been the closest Oklahoma State Cowboy to that football that J.W. Walsh threw to nowhere.
There is no foul for intentional grounding. The ball went beyond the line of scrimmage, and quarterback's outside the tackle box.
He's outside the tackle box, and that ball went beyond the line of scrimmage, so that's okay. Now, the one earlier where he was in the box and he didn't have an intended receiver nearby, that one should have been flagged.
That Twitter handle, at CFB Rules Expert, is the way you can follow our rules expert, Dave Kataya. He tweets on all of these different rules decisions in the games, and he's had some good ones in our game today. Smith. Brought down on third down and driven back. And it looks like Oklahoma State will have to settle for a field goal. And going all the way back, by the way, to the Daniel Sams fumble at the other end of the field that set up this whole sequence, Dave Kataya tweeted and agreed with us, and more specifically, Rod Gilmore, your take. His tweet at the time was, looked like a pretty good shot of the ball coming out after the runner was down. I have no fumble on that.
The replay booth blew it, and they shouldn't blow those.
And now we've got Jonathan Truman, who ripped the ball out earlier in this last sequence and created the Kansas State takeaway. And he is now injured, so the Kansas State trainer's taking a look before a fourth down play and a field goal opportunity coming for Ben Grogan. But we've got a couple of key plays as we have traded turnovers, although the first in the sequence should not have been a turnover.
Yeah, the credit goes to the Oklahoma State. They get credited with a turnover here. Now, that one should not have been one. The replay booth blew that one. But this one here, they earned. Lady took advantage of a very poor throw by Sams to set up his team. But you have to give K-State some credit in these sudden change situations of holding up and not giving up the big play. I mean, Oklahoma State was inside the 20 here, and they didn't get a touchdown. Once again, they're trying a field goal.
34-yard field goal attempt for the true freshman, the number one kicking recruit from Texas, Ben Grogan, who has had a shaky start to his Oklahoma State career. Made one earlier, though, and this one is right down the middle again. So settling down and making some big kicks today is Ben Grogan. And it is a one-point game late in the third quarter. Back and forth we go in Stillwater, and there's a good chance they will go back and forth tonight in Evanston. Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Windows. The nation's longest win streak is on the line as Urban Meyer and Pat Fitzgerald's teams square off. Number 4, Ohio State, against number 16, Northwestern. It's been a while since game day visited Evanston, but they were there today. Saturday Night Football, ABC, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific tonight as we take a look at the dual quarterback threat for the Northwestern Wildcats. And Trevor Siemian and Kane Coulter are both having terrific years.
Yeah, but I think this is a night for Kane Coulter. I mean, given what I think they have to do on offense, I think they have to play Coulter more, a little bit more running from the quarterback, spreading out that Ohio State defense, and they're going to have to find a way to keep pace with the Ohio State offense, because I think that's a mismatch with the Ohio State offense against the Northwestern defense.
Kip Smith got into this one, and Morgan Burns hesitated and now brings it out from 2 yards deep, and the hesitation costs him big time. Rather than hesitating, just take a knee, and instead it'll be inside the 10-yard line to start for Kansas State. Now it's a one-point game. How do you see the momentum shift from here from a K-State perspective, now having to start inside their own 10?
Well, K-State has to get Sam settled down because his last two possessions have resulted in turnovers. So they have a good plan. I mean, they're running the ball more. They're opening it up the empty formation. That's a good deal, but they have to take care of the football. They're without receivers, so throwing the ball down the field has been an issue for them.
They have a couple of plays, though, in the past game that have been surprising with their lack of experience at the receiver spot. Terrell Miller had a terrific drive 2 possessions ago and ended up catching a touchdown. But let's see now in a one-point game inside their own 10-yard line what the play calling is. And it'll be a handoff right into the teeth of the Oklahoma State defense. Calvin Barnett brings down John Hubert as we go back to Chris Cotton.
Bob, a good one over on ESPNU. Georgia Tech in Miami. Tech led 17-7. Miami comes storming right back. Stephen Morris to Allen Hurns. Shakes a tackler midfield. 69 yards for the score. Kane's up top, but Georgia Tech driving.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. Right now it's Kansas State on top, and they are trying to put together a drive of their own, beginning deep in their own end with a one-point lead late in the third quarter. Bob Wischusen alongside Rod Gilmore. Down on the field is Quint Kesnick. And this has been a very interesting back-and-forth game. And now a quarterback switch for the first time in a long time. We see Jake Waters out there at quarterback for K-State.
Who's the tailback?
And Daniel Sams lines up in the backfield. And now with 10 on the play clock, Sams moves to the left of Waters in the shotgun. Waters on a straight throw, high to the sideline. Boy, cold off the bench.
Yeah.
And you wonder if that's a play that Waters checked to because he did seem to make an adjustment at the line.
Yeah, because it would be a tough deal to bring him in after he's been standing over there for a long time and just have him throw that deal. I think he checked it. I think you're absolutely right. We saw the adjustment there.
And remember, Quinn Kesnick asked Bill Snyder going off before halftime, would we see both quarterbacks in the game simultaneously again? And he said, yeah, probably. So Waters stays in. He is now 1-for-4 passing in the game, and it's 3rd down and 7. He's inside the 5, under pressure, lost the football. He spiked it into the ground. Is it ruled a fumble, or was that an incomplete pass? Tyler Johnson got a hand up on Jake Waters and got the football out.
That is the 8th turnover.
It belongs to Oklahoma State. Now, was Waters' arm coming forward? Did he spike the ball into the ground, which would be an incomplete pass and not a fumble?
Yeah, it didn't look like that in real time. Now, if there's any movement forward, the benefit goes to the quarterback. But that ball never came up. The arm never came up. That's a good call on the field. That is a fumble.
Sean Lewis recovered it, and no question, Rod, you could see, I thought his arm coming forward to the naked eye, maybe the ball was still in there, but you're right. Clearly, it was knocked out before.
And that is Waters' 8th turnover of the season.
And if I'm Kansas State, and I'm a Kansas State fan watching back in Manhattan, I'm wondering, inside your own 10-yard line, why do you have the other quarterback who is ice cold coming off the bench throwing from right in front of your own goal line?
I agree completely. I think it had something to do with the fact that Sam's had 2 straight possessions with turnovers, and they changed up, but that's a tough deal.
And now Sam's is over as the counselor on the sideline to Waters as Walsh goes to work. Walsh on a keeper, stood up at the 6. Gang tackled, no gain on first down. It'll be 2nd down and goal, and you can sense the angst from the Cowboy fans here in Stillwater with their offense, wondering if they're going to be able to get the ball in the end zone.
We've seen it. Their offense has struggled last week, and in this ball game in the red zone, Kansas State has been tough. Now, will you see Walsh check to throwing the football down here?
Now, instead, you're going to see a quarterback change. Clint Shelf coming off the bench.
He's cold, too.
So both coaches go to ice-cold quarterbacks in extremely impactful situations.
Well, Walsh may have come out of the ballgame because he lost his helmet.
If his helmet came off, he has to come out for one play. And I didn't see if his helmet popped off. So here's Chell for at least a play. He'll throw. Batted down at the line. Let's see if J.W. Walsh comes right back in.
Yeah,
he will.
Yeah, I mean, if his helmet came off, you don't want a cold quarterback in coming in the red zone there trying to throw it, get it done for you.
They're leaving Shelf in the game.
I'm surprised.
So if J.W. Walsh had to come off the field because of his helmet coming off, he's only required to be out for one play. Instead, it's Clint Shelf on 3rd and goal.
Not an easy situation for Shelf.
Here comes the blitz. Shelf hit as he throws, and it's incomplete. And the turnover, again, it looks like, will only cost K-State 3 points. Shaquille Reed brought pressure and hit Shelf just as he was set to throw the ball. Now, where is the field goal unit? On 4th down from the 6, Shelf is looking back to the sideline, and so far, no field goal unit has come out with the play clock at 18.
Are you serious? You got a chance to kick one to go ahead, and they may go for it instead?
Well, the play clock is winding down. The game clock is stopped, so there's no time advantage to winding the play clock down. I'm not sure why they're waiting this amount of time to now call a timeout, which I would imagine they're doing, unless they're letting the 5 yards back up a little bit further for a better angle for Ben Grogan.
Yeah.
That makes sense. What didn't at first appear to make sense, now all of a sudden it all comes clear.
Guys, J.W. Walsh thought he was back in the ballgame after the helmet infraction. Actually ran 5 yards onto the field. Assistant coach said, no, we're staying with Chell for that last play. Very interesting.
And very interesting as well, Quint, the chess match continues. Bill Snyder declined the penalty. So while Oklahoma State tried to take the delay of game to give Ben Grogan a better angle and back him up 5 yards, Kansas State said not so fast. And Grogan hooks it just inside the upright. to give Oklahoma State the lead back and forth. Fascinating coaching decisions from both sidelines and how both coaches are right on top of the intentions of the other.
Fully aware of how to push the buttons and put the pressure on each other. Pressure on the kicker there to make one after he struggled a bit, and he comes through with it.
Well, these are two coaches that every now and then, like any coach, might make a decision that we can second guess or even first guess. But these are not dummies on either sideline. They are thinking through a lot of different scenarios, and that last scenario, very interesting. Mike Gundy wants the delay of game to give his freshman a better angle. Bill Snyder, realizing exactly what he's trying to do, declines the penalty. And Grogan, from a tough angle, just did sneak it inside the upright for a two-point lead. It's a fun game.
Absolutely. Who would have thought K-State would lose their two top receivers and have 11 penalties and be in this ball game?
And Oklahoma State still has not committed an accepted penalty. Smith to kick off. This one returnable for Burns from the two. And can't get past the 16-yard line before he's thrown back. Tailgate week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal, continues tonight. Undefeated Pac-12 North rivals meet. Number 15, Washington, led by Keith Price, taking on Kevin Hogan. And number 5, Stanford. That's tonight on ESPN at 10:30 Eastern, also live on Watch ESPN.
And Bishop Sankey, he sunk 40 carries last week. They are giving him the ball an awful lot. Nice matchup between Sankey and Tyler Gaffney, Stanford's fine running back who gave up professional baseball to come back to the Stanford Cardinal this year.
A runner like that takes some pressure off the quarterback.
Absolutely.
Still debating whether or not I want to be sitting next to Rod Gilmore watching that game tonight. Watching a contested Stanford game with you could be fun, but then again, maybe not so much.
Protect yourself.
Daniel Sams back in at quarterback. Quarterback draw. He protects the ball and almost picks up a first down.
Three straight possessions, Kansas State turned over the football. The quarterbacks. The Sams fumble, the Sams pick, and then Waters came in and fumbled the ball. So now the number one thing they're all thinking about and told, take care of the football.
Second down and one. The only true experienced receiver that Kansas State has healthy and on the field is Curry Sexton. He's in the slot right. Sams again will run. Breaks a tackle, has the first down and more. Uses the stiff arm before he's ridden out of bounds by Sean Lewis. Ryan Simmons couldn't bring him down at the line.
He just threw him off. And Simmons had a great shot at him, and Sams just said, get off me. Watch him. Heading to his right. Here comes Simmons. Got him right there. Couldn't wrap him up. Just throws him off. Just get off me. Uses that good left arm to push him away.
Terrific play by the senior veteran Sean Lewis, making his 37th straight start today. And he is one of the champion linebackers that Glenn Spencer talked about. He and Caleb Levy are his two workhorses that he depends upon.
Well, Spencer understands that this is a run-focused offense now with those wide receivers out, and he's not afraid to bring pressure. He might even bring it here on second and long, anticipating a quarterback draw, a screen pass, but assuming that they just don't want to drop back and throw the ball down the field.
Sams on second and long. Long throw, hits Sexton. Sexton lost the ball, but it goes out of bounds before it could be recovered by either team. Sean Lewis was able to rip it away from Curry Sexton. That was almost another turnover on Kansas State.
It's like K-State has a case of the dropsies. I mean, Sexton here has a chance to pick up more yardage and doesn't secure the ball, running loosely with it with one arm barely covering it up, and it gets stripped.
Now it goes back to the point of the fumble. He can't fumble it forward, so it still does set up third down, but third down and two after a pretty big second down completion. And this
Now remember, in this formation, they have usually numbers advantage when they run Sams. They have more blockers than defenders. Or they will get the man-to-man matchup. Right now, Oklahoma State has committed more guys in the box to try and stop the quarterback run.
Big play, third down and two. And now flags all over the place. Another Kansas State penalty.
Yeah, they tried to make the change. Sam saw what we talked about. Oklahoma State brought an extra guy into the box. Sam's checked because he saw the man-to-man coverage and wanted to try and to beat that.
That should take us to the end of the third quarter and sets up a huge play when we come back to start the fourth. Oklahoma State takes a two-point lead to the fourth quarter at home here in Stillwater. Back and forth we go between K-State and OSU. A big one in the Big 12. We'll come back to Stillwater following these messages and a word from the ABC station. This broadcast is brought to you by Vizio, live and in color and in crystal clear HD. As we return to Stillwater, Bob Wischusen alongside Rod Gilmore, down in the field, Quinn Kesnick. We start the fourth quarter with a huge play. Third and seven for Kansas State, now down by two. Daniel Sam scoops up the low snap, doesn't see the blitz coming. Tyler Johnson untouched off the edge on a protection breakdown for K-State.
They bring him from that area over there. Tyler Johnson will just come free. A blown pass protection assignment. They slid the line to the right. My guess is Hubert is supposed to go to the left, scan that way, and pick him up. He didn't, and Johnson was home free.
Tyler Johnson, originally a walk-on here at Oklahoma State. Josh Stewart back to receive the punt, and this will take a high K-State hop. Out of bounds inside the 30. At the OSU 28-yard line. Well, last year down by two in the fourth quarter on the road. Would have been much more comforting to be able to turn things over to that young man. Colin Klein, of course, a finalist for the Heisman. Still working out in Manhattan, awaiting for a call to see if somebody in the NFL might be interested in bringing him in. He was in camp with the Houston Texans, we understand. But without a job in football right now, but boy, having his wisdom around the campus to talk to these quarterbacks can't be a bad thing.
And regardless of the NFL prospects, he was a great, great college football player.
J.W. Walsh back in at quarterback for Oklahoma State. Wide receiver hits to Tracy Moore, whose trip up after a gain of 3.5. Ty Zimmerman came up to make the stop.
Talk about blown opportunities for Oklahoma State in the third quarter. They forced three turnovers. They didn't have a first down. They got only 6 points out of it. They had 15 total yards of offense in the third quarter.
And some of the boos from the fans here in Stillwater. Another catch for Tracy Moore. Another stop by one of the safeties. That time it's Dante Barnett. It'll be third down and two coming now for the Pokes. A chance for a three and out for Kansas State on defense, as J.W. Walsh tries to keep the drive alive. Blitz coming, low throw, incomplete, three downs and out.
Now this is going to set off the crowd. The crowd's not going to like it because it looked like Walsh had his guy there and kind of short-armed it. It didn't look like he got hit.
The other element to how Oklahoma State plays as well, and we saw this last week for West Virginia, the teams that go super fast, maximum snaps, maximum possessions, they don't eat up a lot of time. And now Kip Smith with a sideways punt. We saw this last week as well. That'll be covered up out at the 44-yard line. Kip Smith had two terrible punts last week. Both led to West Virginia touchdowns in Morgantown. That's only a 21-yarder. Great field position for K-State.
You're watching ESPN College Football on ABC. presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
The polls are closing. It's your last chance to head to at ESPNCFB on Twitter. Use the hashtag OKStateTailgate. You saw under the big top, that's the converted ambulance tailgate, and then In the Shade, which was just a monster tailgate that we found outside. This is tailgate week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. Vote for your favorite. There were some good ones today that we were able to show you here in Stillwater. And it's back to the offense after a 21-yard punt by Oklahoma State for Kansas State. John Hubert goes up the middle for a gain of 3.5. Great field position for Kansas State, down by 2. So the pressure back on an Oklahoma State defense that has played very well for the most part this season for Glenn Spencer.
And they've been on the field an awful lot in this ball game. Kansas State has gone to this ball control offense in the second half. They are missing their two top receivers. It's been a lot of Sams running the ball and then short passes.
Chess match continues as Oklahoma State might change their defense. Sams finds a lane. He's got a first down. Let's go back to Chris Cotter.
Bob, let's go to Knoxville. Vols in their home grays and giving Georgia a fight here. Bulldogs back to punt. Jalen Reeves-Maven blocks it. Devon Swafford picks it up, returns at 15 yards. 17 all right now after three, but the Bulldogs are driving.
Well, Chris, Kansas State is driving here in Stillwater, down by 2. And the Cowboy fans hoping for a stop. And again, they take the play clock down under 10. Daniel Sams waits for his blockers, and boy, he gets pounded after a gain of 5. Caleb Levy was the first player there for Oklahoma State. A gain of only 4 on first down, 2nd and 6, and Sams really took a shot.
Well, they're pulling their linemen to get into this power, quarterback power running play. 55 Whitehair is the guy they pulled that time. The play before, it was Keenan Taylor. So they're getting their big guys out in front to get the extra blocker in front of their quarterback, Sams. Now look for Oklahoma State to think about blitzing in when they're pulling those linemen to get a tackle behind the line of scrimmage.
Sams with 151 yards passing, 91 yards rushing. Play clock down to 3. 2nd down and 6. Well protected. Throws one low left, and that one is scooped up. A catch for Kyle Klein.
Great catch. Klein came back about 5 yards to make that catch. Watch the end of this. Klein will just keep working back until he dives to pick that up. That's a huge, huge grab.
The younger brother of Colin Klein, who's on the sideline only about 8 to 10 yards away from where his baby brother just made that catch. And he loved it. It's a K-State first down. Another chance for Sams to run. And he's hit and dropped after a gain of 3 by Tyler Johnson.
Well, they're running the same play. Did you see them pull Whitehair this time, 55? You know, they're doing that. It's the quarterback power, get a big lineman out in front. And I'm just waiting on Oklahoma State to say, you know what? We got to really shoot the gap. We got to bring an extra guy and try and make a play behind the line of scrimmage. And if they catch a minute, if Sams catches them and gets single coverage, he'll take a shot.
Sams finds a cutback lane and just does get dragged down by the ankles by Ryan Simmons. And if Simmons doesn't get Sams down at about the 22-yard line, nobody might have gotten him before he got to the pylon.
Every play on this drive has been that quarterback power, pulling a guard or a tackle, except for one play, except for the throw.
Defensively, do you worry about the over-pursuit with the cutback lane? It almost happened there. Is that your concern if you're Glenn Spencer?
Absolutely. With a guy like this, he's an electric runner.
Important play here, 3rd down and 4. And Sams with 8 on the play clock, still trying to get his team set. Long throw to the outside. Coming back to make the catch is Kyle Klein again. And it's 1st and goal at the 10.
Klein is just continuing to make plays. I mean, he's not outrunning his defender, the guy covering him. He just works back. He goes up to him and then works his way back, fights off of him to make the catch. That time he beats Patman, just coming back to Sams again.
First and goal with 9 minutes remaining. Sams spins free, not so much. And trying to rip the ball out was Caleb Levy. And instead, he threw Sams to the ground in the process. With 8.5 minutes to go, it will be second and goal, but now from the 11.
Well, and you saw the pressure. I mean, they brought all the blitzers that time. They brought Sean Lewis from the outside. Levy came from the inside, anticipating more of that quarterback power run, trying to get into the backfield.
Clock down to five again. Kansas State just gets the playoff and the quick pass to the edge to Curry Sexton. And he picks up 2 yards. Now it will be third down and goal at the 9.
Well, and if you're Kansas State, you have to be somewhat careful about your play selection here. I mean, you have 3 points in your back pocket. You can kick a field goal if you don't pick this up and go ahead by a point in this ball game. And you've had a number of turnovers already in this game. So you want to make sure that Sams has a safe play and understands that if it ain't a first down or touchdown, save the down.
Sams on third and goal, steps up in the pocket, fires end zone. There's the flag. No doubt about it. Kevin Peterson with the first penalty of the day for Oklahoma State, and is that one ever costly? And for those that have just joined us, welcome to Stillwater. Bob Wischusen here with Rod Gilmore, Quinn Kesnick down on the field. We have had a back-and-forth affair all afternoon between Oklahoma State and Kansas State. Oklahoma State, a moment ago, took the lead on a field goal after we went back and forth with a series of turnovers. This, the first possession to start the fourth quarter for Kansas State, and it has eaten the clock down to 7 minutes to go. That last penalty, the first of the day against Oklahoma State, making it first and goal. Daniel Sams on the keeper, gets shut down at about the 3-yard line. It will be second down and goal as Caleb Levy made the stop for OSU.
Well, it's been the same play they've run on this drive. They've run it to the left, they've run it to the right. Oklahoma State has now decided they're going to blitz the formation every time to force them to do something else. And a question here is, will Kansas State take a chance early and go away from that play? They have a lot of confidence in it.
Terrell Miller, wide left to the top of your screen, has a touchdown catch. Sams, with the play clock winding down, gets it off. Trying to move the pile. Where's the football? Where is Sams? He's in the end zone for a K-State touchdown.
Well, Sams got by with a little help from his friends. Hey, watch the push he gets from Whitehair, his lineman number 55. Sams, look at him just drive him into the end zone. Look at him push him in, all the way in. Now, that's not going to be called because you're just a big pile and a whole lot of guys there. But you remember the Bush push? That's a push.
Now with Kansas State on top by 4, rather than try to take a 5-point lead and kick the extra point, they are going to go for 2 here to try and stretch the lead to 6.
That's the right decision here in the fourth quarter.
You never know what might happen on a special teams play in college football. And now a timeout call by Kansas State. So enough indecision for Bill Snyder on the 2-point conversion, and he does not seem happy with his offense that they spend one of their timeouts. But Still in all, the short field after a short punt by Oklahoma State turns into a touchdown for Kansas State.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, brought to you by Buffalo Wild Wings, the official hangout for NCAA football. The Venture Card from Capital One. Earn double miles you can actually use. And AT&T. Rethink possible.
Back here in Stillwater, a perfect day for football. Pistol Pete's had a good time. And it's still after the timeout. Appears like Kansas State is going to go for two to try and take the lead from, instead of being up by five and kicking the point after, to being up six.
I have no problem with that. I think when you're up by less than a touchdown in the fourth quarter and you're counting possessions left, no problem, go for this.
The only problem is if you fail to make this and Oklahoma State comes back and scores a touchdown, it could end up hurting you.
Same difference if it's 5 points though.
Sams set to throw. Fires one into the end zone and it is caught on the slide. Terrell Miller's got the two.
Great patience by Sams. Great protection, but great patience to wait.
6:09 remaining, and now Kansas State has a six-point lead.
And Sams takes his time, poised, patience, waiting. Miller comes into view, and there it is, the two-point conversion.
Welcome back to Stillwater, ESPN College Football on ABC, presented by Buffalo Wild Wings, all part of Tailgate Week, fired up by Kingsford Charcoal. And we have been fired up back and forth all afternoon here in Stillwater. For those that might be just joining us, this is like center court at Wimbledon. Serve and volley between Kansas State and Oklahoma State as K-State has the lead back, 29-23. Now it's back on the Oklahoma State offense and a kickoff that will go through the back of the end zone. So at the 25, Oklahoma State will start. As we take a look at our Pacific Life game summary.
Well, Daniel Sams has been the offense for Kansas State after losing both of their top receivers. They've turned to the rushing attack, and it's been pull a lineman left and pull one right, run that quarterback power, the same play over and over, and Sams has delivered with a big rushing afternoon for Kansas State. 98 yards and a touchdown on 25 carries. And he's also thrown the ball pretty decently.
A day that we expected to be almost an even split between Daniel Sams and Jake Waters at quarterback, instead has been mostly Daniel Sams, and that's been the right move for Bill Snyder, especially considering his wide receiver injuries. J.W. Walsh back to work over the middle, and that one is held onto. That's good for a first down to Josh Stewart.
That is the first down of the second half from Oklahoma State.
It's been a long time since Cowboy fans have seen their offense struggle the way this offense is struggling now. Walsh on a play action fake. Looks for the deep ball up the seam, and there's anything but a struggle on this drive. Tracy Moore's got a first down inside the 40 down to the K-State 37.
You know, one of the changes that Oklahoma State has made, the right side of the line, they have now changed their right guard and taken out the starter who was over there, Grisby, and gone with Cross. And Kansas State was picking on that right side. They were bringing pressure over there and having some action, and now they switched up.
Jeremy Smith breaks a tackle, breaks another, down to the 21.
A huge hole on the right side. And they weren't able to run this way and get things done before, but what a great, great cutoff block they got by Brandon Webb, the left guard who got out there on the middle linebacker.
Making the catch, breaking a tackle, Brandon Shepherd. And he's down to the 5 yard line. First and goal just inside the six for the Cowboys.
Keep in mind, the last two times Oklahoma State got down here, they came away with field goals. They did not put it in the end zone.
6 yards away from possibly taking the lead back again with 4:40 to go. Six players right up near the line.
Tipping the pressure. They looked like they were going to be in zone first, but now they're starting to show blitz and man coverage behind it.
And J.W. Walsh might have checked off. On the slant, end zone, incomplete. No flag out. Brandon Shepard thought he was held.
Now, good play by Kip Daly. Good play by Daly.
So now it's second down and goal at the six.
As long as you don't turn the receiver with your offhand, you will not be flagged for pass interference on plays like that. You can reach around, and you can even have your hand on his hip, but as long as you don't turn him around, it's going to be a good play.
Kansas State shows blitz. Here they come. On the edge. Toe tap. Inside the pylon. Charlie Moore's got a touchdown. And at least for the moment, we are tied.
Well, Charlie Moore has been quiet most of the day, but he got matched up with Daly one-on-one and just runs a simple out and gives his quarterback room to deliver the ball, and Walsh puts it right there. You see Zimmerman in the middle. That told Walsh he had single coverage outside, and he goes out there to Moore.
Terrific bang-bang call by the officials as well. They may review just to make sure. The replay booth is not buzzed down, but it looked like the right foot clearly came down in the orange paint before the left foot hit the pylon out of bounds. And the point after is added. 4:13 to go, and now it goes back to Kansas State. They're down by a point after a six-play touchdown drive that only took a minute and 56 seconds.
That's in.
The first catch of the day for Charlie Moore. Back to ESPN College Football on ABC. The toe tap a moment ago by Charlie Moore. His first catch of the day makes for our seventh lead change of the day between Oklahoma State and Kansas State.
Yeah, great job by Moore over there. And now you start to wonder, is it the last team with the football that matters today?
Morgan Burns from the five gets out to the 21. Let's go back to Chris Cotter.
Indiana's Nate Sudfeld looked like an AT&T All-American today. 321 yards and two touchdowns. The Hoosiers beat the Nittany Lions for the first time ever, 44-24. Get involved. Text your vote for the AT&T All-American of the Week to 34763. Bob?
There's an eye opener from the Big Ten.
Yeah.
I think Kirk Herbstreit called that.
I think he did. Yeah, I think Herbie had that one.
On game day earlier today, he thought Indiana was going to have a chance to go to Happy Valley and make things not so happy. Kansas State down by a point, plenty of time on the clock. Sams looking for the home run ball, underthrows it terribly, and it's intercepted by Sean Lewis. Lewis with some blockers all the way down to the 17-yard line. Fourth K-State turnover.
And no pressure on Sams. He just threw it into coverage and threw it short.
It looks like Calvin Barnett is the injured player for Oklahoma State. The big defensive tackle from Tulsa injured on the return. So the crowd quiet for a moment, but they'll get loud again in just a second. And Glenn Spencer knows that that's the kind of play he needs one of his senior linebackers to make, and Sean Lewis dropping back in coverage was in position.
Yeah, and this Oklahoma State defense has been coming up with plays all season long. They've been put in a tough position, but they've made plays at times when they need to, like here. But you have to wonder, if you're a Kansas State fan, why did you change your philosophy on this drive when you've controlled the line of scrimmage and you had 4+ minutes in the ballgame? I mean, I expected them to come out and pound and run down the clock and try to move into field goal position.
And Barnett now being helped up to his feet. That gets a cheer from the fans here in Stillwater.
Now, what's next for Oklahoma State here. They've had a tendency to go fast.
And Kansas State with two timeouts left, certainly not compelled to use them, no matter what happens here. Even if Oklahoma State were to score a touchdown,
yeah,
you still probably have a one possession game.
Exactly, exactly.
So Kansas State, as long as their defense is able to get either a stop, even if they allow a score, most likely will have one more chance with the football. But this is a big sequence now for Oklahoma State, as they can at least, if they get any type of points here, put Kansas State in a position where they'll have to have a touchdown. J.W. Walsh on a rollout. Finds Seaton. Spins off a tackler, but goes out of bounds.
You don't want that. If you're Oklahoma State, you want the clock to run, and you want to put points on the board. You want to put as much pressure on Kansas State as you can. But again, here, they hurry up anyway.
Well, the officials set the ball ready for play, which means that the clock starts until we're inside of 2 minutes. And let's see how early in the play clock Oklahoma State snaps the football. And J.W. Walsh looks like patiently letting it wind down, keeping an eye on the play clock. It's down to 10.
That's smart.
Second down and 5. They keep it on the ground with Jeremy Smith. And Smith moves the pile within about 2 yards of the first down, and that will keep the clock rolling as we will go inside of 3 minutes to go, and Kansas State not opting to spend either of their timeouts.
Smart play calling by Oklahoma State. Burn the clock, put the pressure on Kansas State, put them in the position where they may have to use a timeout if they want to preserve some clock, and put yourself in position for more points.
And now an eclipse. It's an Oklahoma State huddle. You don't normally see that, as they're going to let the clock wind all the way down, and maybe they'll spend one of their timeouts to take the maximum amount of time off the clock. Mike Gundy,
smart move,
now calls timeout from the Oklahoma State sideline. We will step aside for 45 seconds and come right back to Stillwater. It's a one-point game. Welcome back to Stillwater, where the fans of the Cowboys trying to urge their team to a back-and-forth victory. We have had 7 lead changes between Kansas State and Oklahoma State. Bob Wischusen here with Rod Gilmore and Quint Kesnick. It's been a terrific back-and-forth affair. And Oklahoma State has used the turnover battle to win in the past, 40-5 under Mike Gundy, when they're plus in turnovers, and they are plus today.
If you're Kansas State defensively, what do you expect, Bob?
You're expecting, I would think, a run to the left to try and center up the field goal kicker if you don't get the first down. Let's see where it goes. And instead, heading to the right is Walsh. And he has stood up, and now, 2 timeouts remaining, Bill Snyder spins one. Dante Barnett didn't get fooled. He stayed home on the backside and was there to bring down J.W. Walsh.
Well, and this makes things tougher. He's going to come out and head this way. Watch all the pressure that comes out anticipating this. We assume they would try and make sure they got back to the middle of the field in case they didn't pick up the first down to have an easier field goal. Now, this is a more difficult one from the far hash.
Well, on that replay, you could see the entire defensive front for Kansas State slant to the right, thinking that was where the running play might go. But a good job by Barnett to hold the edge on the backside.
That's
staying
just what
disciplined.
They're expecting us to do. So we'll do what they don't expect us to do.
So now Grogan, and we saw earlier, Mike Gundy tried to take an intentional delay of game penalty in this type of a situation to back Grogan up to give him a better angle. Now it looks like from 28 yards, they're set to kick it away.
Had a kick 6 earlier for K-State.
And Grogan has it. He's been good today. So now Kansas State, with still a lot of time left, has to have a touchdown. As we take a look at today's good hands play brought to you by Allstate, and a trick play for Oklahoma State back in the first half.
Trickeration. Walsh, Smith, getting it out to Seals. Seals comes up with a good catch when the ball was underthrown. And that set up an Oklahoma State touchdown.
That was the end result of a flea flicker that got Seals behind the coverage and should have been a walk-in touchdown, but Seals trying to adjust to the football fell at the one. One play later, Jeremy Smith went over from 1 yard away. So now a much more interesting set of circumstances as well, Rod, for Kansas State. You talked about how they're play calling the last possession with 4 minutes and two timeouts, needing only a field goal, could still involve their entire repertoire, the run game of Daniel Sams. You can bleed the clock down. You didn't have to worry as much about the clock. Now you've got 2:24 and one timeout. How does that adjust what Bill Snyder and his offensive coaches call?
You saw Waters warming up. They may bring him in. They can no longer run the time-consuming offense that they had the opportunity to run earlier. I still didn't get that whole decision-making process to come out throwing when it was 4+ minutes ago and they had dominated the line of scrimmage.
It's a pretty short kickoff. Comes down to John Hubert at the 10. And he is able to move out to about the 23-yard line. Saturday Night Football on ABC presented by Windows. A big one of the Big Ten tonight. It brought game day to Evanston, and now under the lights, it'll be Ohio State and Northwestern. Saturday Night Football on ABC at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, as Urban Meyer and Pat Fitzgerald square off.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think you look at that Ohio State offense, Hyde, Miller. I see a lot of big plays for Ohio State on offense tonight.
And now Jake Waters comes off the bench cold. So the passing quarterback now forced into the game with one timeout and 2:18 to go.
Well, the last time he came on the field, he had a turnover.
Waters out to the edge. Hubert. And they will rule that a catch. He would have been better off having dropped the football because that keeps the clock rolling, and it's a gain of maybe a half yard.
You need a lot of yards. You have one timeout, and you're going to face a defense that will give you short passes and nothing deep.
Four-man rush. Waters dodging tacklers in the pocket, throws one low, and it's incomplete. Intended for Terrell Miller. Now it's third down and 10, and what will obviously be four down territory.
And this is where experience matters. You have to remember that Waters is a JC transfer, his first season. You have to understand what you're getting defensively, and Oklahoma State is playing basically Tampa 2. When they're playing two deep coverage and then running a guy deep down the field, they're giving you the short passes. You can't look down the field deep.
Third down and 10. Blitz comes off the edge. They've got the screen set up behind it. Hubert is brought down to the 31-yard line. It will be fourth down and 3. Kansas State only has one timeout left, so they have to hurry unless they think that calling the timeout here is important enough, and they do, to set up the fourth down play. Now, to second guess, if we backtrack, when you have about 2.5 minutes to go with college football rules, the clock stopping when you pick up a first down, things that aid you in lengthening the game, even with only one timeout, is it panicking to put the passing quarterback in there, thinking that Daniel Sams couldn't still be in there as a dual threat? You could still run the ball and maybe give yourself a chance with the guy who's been playing quarterback the whole game.
I don't know that you can run it that much. I just think it's tough and unfair to put a guy like Waters in that situation. He has not played most of the game. You brought him in cold, you know, for one play early in the third quarter after he'd set out the entire game and he turned the ball over. And now he sits for another 45 minutes. You bring him in and you say win the game. That's a tough position to be in.
And now look who's coming back in for the fourth down play. It'll be Daniel Sams. You've got Tremaine Thompson on the sideline. He was not able to play. Tyler Lockett, the best receiver that Kansas State has, pulled his hamstring earlier. So he's been out ever since. And now coming back off the bench is Daniel Sams, more of a run threat. Empty backfield, fourth down and 3. Sams, straight throw, right at the first down marker. Curry Sexton makes the catch. And with 1:35 to go, that will stop the clock and let Kansas State get set up as they leave Sams in at quarterback.
And if you had left Sams in all along, at least you have the scrambling threat and a guy who can make guys miss and maybe get you some chunks of yardage occasionally.
And now some confusion for Kansas State. They finally get set, but they're out of timeouts. Sams scrambles. Gets to the 40. Can he get out of bounds? And does. Ridden out of bounds by Lewis. And that stops the clock at the 45-yard line of Oklahoma State with a minute 10 to go.
And that's the dynamic you have with him that you don't have with Waters. And when you lose Thompson and Lockett, you need a difference maker on the field. And Sams is the only guy that can give you chunks and big plays. That's a 19-yarder right there.
It's exactly what we were talking about, the element that he still provides. And now that he is back out there, it's a further headache for the Oklahoma State defense. Four-man rush again. Sams will scramble again. This time he's grabbed by Sean Lewis and brought down a gain of only two.
Yeah,
and obviously that runs the clock.
Lewis playing the spy position is athletic enough to make the play.
Down to 52 seconds to go. Sams needs to get his team set. Kansas State has to have a touchdown. 45 seconds remaining. Oklahoma State continues to rush four with a spy. Sams throws one, no one home. And at least stops the clock before third down with 37 seconds left.
They wasted an awful lot of time before snapping that last ball. Needed a little bit more of a sense of urgency. You still have a couple plays to pick it up. And at the worst, in the worst case scenario, you can get the first down and have a chance at a Hail Mary. But you got two plays to pick this up.
Third down with 37 seconds left. Three-man rush. Sams, all kinds of time. Throws one, and it's a room service interception. That'll end the game. Daytwon Lowe has no need to even return this. Why not just lay down? The game's over. He might bring it the distance. Inside the five and hammer out at the two. He has a fumble and three interceptions on the ledger today.
Well, forcing the football, Oklahoma State would give you the short pass, but there was no way they were going to let you throw it deep. They have too many men deep for that. And Lowe comes up with the big play, and Oklahoma State, they just kept their Big 12 championship hopes alive.
Well, Daytwon Lowe returned it all the way down to the 7-yard line. And now all J.W. Walsh has to do is take a knee. And the turnovers will end a valiant effort from Kansas State. And again, the Oklahoma State defense proves to be the key element in them not even just staying in a game, but coming up with a big win at home.
Well, that third quarter, their offense had 23 yards of offense and didn't get a first down. But the Oklahoma State defense managed to just keep them close.
J.W. Walsh makes it official, and Oklahoma State survives at home against Kansas State. That's two smart, admirable coaches and two teams that play awfully hard as we go down to Quint Kesnick.
Coach, a game that featured seven lead changes. What ultimately made the difference?
Well, obviously our defense at the end really rose to the occasion. We've been in these situations before and not got the stop. And we had some turnovers, but our defense forced some turnovers. And we recovered in our kicking game. Our kicker did a nice job after a terrible week last week.
Why were you able to force second half five turnovers?
Well, I think that we disguised our coverages. I think we were getting a little bit of pressure there at the end. But for the most part, it looked like we had good spacing on the defense and we were in the right position.
This was a critical game in conference. What does it mean now to stay in the hunt in the league race?
Well, you know, when you have these games where they're close like this, you got to find a way to win if you're going to be there in the end. And Kansas State played a great game, and it's two really good teams. A lot of fun to watch. Not good for the coaches, but a lot of fun for the fans.
Congratulations, Coach.
Thanks.
Bob.
Mike Gundy could not have summed it up better. A lot of fun for the fans and a lot of fun for the announcers. That was a blast of a football game to be able to call. Terrific effort by both Kansas State and Oklahoma State. And the Cowboys survive 33-29. Hopefully at 8 Eastern, it will be just as entertaining. Saturday Night Football presented by Windows. Two undefeated teams facing off when Ohio State meets Northwestern. Thanks so much for joining us this afternoon from Stillwater. Again, Oklahoma State over Kansas State, 33-29.